What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Game Over Greggy Show. I am one of your hosts, Greg Miller, alongside the producer slash seducer, Nick Scarpino.
Hey, Greg.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm well.
How was that ice you were chewing on?
It was really good.
Yeah? Do you ever refill the ice in our house?
I do.
Okay. It wasn't me judging. I just rarely use it, so I don't even know.
No. Yeah, I do all the time.
All right, good. Thanks. You're a good bro.
He's an ice guy.
I'm trying to be respectful of everything you guys have. It is someone's house. You do have other people that live here that don't. Take part in the madness that is our daily lives.
Kind of like when you're like, oh, I used up all the coffee pods, and then I'll text you like, bring a coffee to me for me tomorrow. Not the pods, just a cup of coffee, because I know you're going to Starbucks.
Yeah.
And then you get here without my Starbucks.
Because you text me right after I left. And you know what? Sometimes it's really a pain in the ass to find parking at Starbucks, and I don't value our friendship that much.
Thank you. As long as somebody's admitting what's really happening here.
I bring you Starbucks. You know, get on with it.
Over here, the pure one, Tim Gettys.
Hello.
No, let Tim host.
No, fucked up with this whole intro thing. I went to go hit the table. I'm like, that's not yet.
You're rusty.
Yeah, it's been a while.
It's a long weekend. Game of Thrones last night.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
Yeah. A lot of Daredevil. And then, right here, the one and only Lorne Lanning. Creator of Oddworld.
Thanks for having me, guys.
You survived Colin and Greg Live today. Of course, Colin over in Iceland, coming home soon. You survived it, and you didn't leave. You ate some Thai food. You hung out. You're ready to talk about whatever we talk about.
I'm here. I'm with you.
You excited?
Thanks for having me.
No, my God, please. Thank you so much for hanging out.
You guys are great.
I also like your glasses a lot.
Oh, thank you very much.
On Colin and Greg Live. There's a lot of things happening. These are nice glasses.
I found a new place to get my glasses.
Lens Crafters.
It's the car wash in Berkeley.
Really?
And they now have the glasses that suit me. Yeah.
There you go. That's great.
You should do a commercial for them.
You might be one of the most fascinating people we've ever had in this house. Like sitting there
eating lunch.
House, huh? No,
man.
We got some stories.
Greg lives with Colin, so that's a high standard. No, we literally, I mean, for those people that can't watch us have lunch every day, we were talking to you for about an hour, and it just flies by because you have fantastic stories that you're probably not allowed to say on this podcast.
There's a few of them,
which is okay. But yeah, we were really excited. And it literally was to a point where Kevin kept tapping us on the shoulder, like, "Hey, you guys have to start the podcast now." Because I'm like, I could listen to this guy talk.
And Nick's like, "Damn it, Kevin, I feed you. I'll tell you when we start the show.
I'll tell you what shirt and underwear to wear combination." I don't know why I said that.
Underoos.
If you didn't know, the Game Over Greggy show is simple. Each and every week, four, sometimes five best friends gather on this table. Each bring a random topic of discussion for your amusement. If you like that, you can get everything early over on patreon.com/kindoffunny each and every Friday. But if you don't want to give us any money, it's no big deal. You can wait for the next week. Starting that Monday, every topic goes up, topic by topic, day by day on youtube.com/kindoffunny until the entire show posts for free on Friday as a video and, of course, a podcast on podcast services around the globe.
Yes.
I felt really good about that one. I've been stumbling because I've gone to vacation. I'd come back. Colin's here. He's gone. I don't know what's happening. That one I got
Colin's
all
here. He's gone.
That one I just nailed. Like, I ripped the skin off the ball.
That was good.
Style.
That was good.
Beautiful. All right. Nice. Lauren.
Yes.
The tradition here is that the guest goes first with their topic.
No!
But when we were talking out there, you decided to ape Kenny Char's topic. From the Patreon. Of course, you go to Patreon. You can support us. Get your topic read on the show. And Kenny's Char.
Yeah.
That would be good if I had a barbecue restaurant and I was named
Kenny's
Kenny.
Char. That'd be awesome.
Right? That's a good one.
Char.
Kenny,
hey,
there you go.
Kenny's Char. It's like Carl's Jr. Carl's Jr.
That's not a...
Let's just keep saying it, Nick.
Which is concerning.
Carl's Jr.
Carl's Jr.
Not a ringing endorsement of Kenny's Char. Anyways, Kenny Char, for his Patreon topic, said, "What were the best movie sequels ever made?" Then he gives this caveat, not including Empire Strikes Back or Godfather Part 2.
You got to not make it easy on us. Because those would be the ones we talk about.
Well, obviously, those are the good ones, right?
There's some other good ones, though. Back to the Future 2, Aliens.
Back to the Future 2 was
now,
great.
Aliens, here's James the one. Cameron. Is Back to the Future 2... Now, I'm willing to have an adult conversation. I haven't thought this through.
Okay.
Is Back to the Future 2 the better movie?
No.
Here's the thing. As a child, very much so did I think... I love the future I could get behind. The past was boring.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But being a grown-up seeing these movies... You're like, well, I think Back to the Future 1 was a bit better. That, you know, you're not selling Pizza Hut product placement in the next one. You know what I mean? That was like the turnaround point. You know what I'm saying? I think it was all tricks before. I think our kid eyes were just happy with a flying car and a flying hover.
So it's like Ninja Turtles, where it's like now you look back and like the first one was definitely better. But when you were a kid, the second one was definitely better.
It had vanilla ice.
It did have vanilla ice.
There you go.
The Bebop and Rocksteady knockoffs.
Yeah.
Whatever the hell the names
were. Gora or something.
Reznor. Who knows?
So, Nick, do you have anything to say about Back to the Future 1 versus 2?
Back to the Future 1 is a classic. Back to the Future 2 was great. And I'm with you. When I was a kid, I loved the hoverboard sequence. I was like, I want a hoverboard. This is the better movie.
Yeah.
This is awesome. I mean, no.
Cooler. It was a cooler movie.
My parents' generation was the generation he goes back to. Because I was, when that movie was made, I think it was 5 years old. So my parents actually grew up probably during that time period. Maybe a little later in that time period, actually.
You've heard the disturbing fact, and it's already passed, that if they did Back to the Future now in present day or whatever, they'd be going back to like 1985 or whatever. Like, that's how old we are and how old that movie is. Yeah, right? Like, it's like, oh, my God. Which they should do. They should just reboot Back to the Future and do that.
That'd be hilarious. They go back to 85. They go back to 85 and we're all like, that'd actually be a blast. But, no, I mean, the second movie was good. And it's funny because my wife actually was one of the ones that brought it to my attention. She was like, you know, the first one's better, right? And I'm like, no way. The second one had this and this and this, and Biff was in the future and all this stuff. And then you watch them back to back, and you're like, oh, you know what? Yeah, it actually has a lot more heart. It is the original. Similar to how the Fast and Furious, the first Fast and Furious movie, is the better Fast and Furious.
I hate you so much. No, I mean, no jokes, though. Like, good sequels, Fast 5, 6, and 7. Like,
they, no,
I mean, they, okay, we can't put them in the same league as the other movies we're talking about.
No, but I would say, no, but those were good
sequels.
Sequels, they were. They were sequels that were actually better, I would imagine. I will go out there and say that they're better than the first. I like the first one. I rank it higher just because I love it. But
nobody likes this tuna fish sandwich.
They fought. That was Fast and Furious.
That was number one.
Yeah, that was it. That's all they did.
Yeah.
Nobody likes this tuna fish sandwich.
The tuna fish. Nobody likes the tuna. You remember this scene.
Nobody likes the tuna.
You remember
that
this.
That when they get in the first time they get in the fight outside of the diner?
You've never even seen it.
What if Nick had never seen a Fast and Furious movie?
Just number one.
Like, all
he just picked up a Tokyo Drift. He's like, yeah.
Hilarious. No, those movies actually are better because they got significantly better because they got more budget and they got more clout. And so they attracted bigger stars. So by the time you get to 5, you got The Rock.
Yeah.
You're like, okay, that's awesome. And they're crazy good.
Someone just made a graph, like a chart, insane, of all the movies of how Fast versus Furious each one is. It's genius.
That was the Vin Diesel Fast.
Yeah, it's like Fast counts as anytime they're in a car or in any in a car, plane, or train, or jumping off of one of those things.
Right.
Sure.
And Furious is when people are fighting or there's melodrama.
It's great.
What are we talking about?
And as you go, it gets
more furious.
No, it gets more like evened out.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah, but both are way higher. It's great.
Of course, the one that's most debated is Aliens, because everyone, that's a split camp for me. Where, like, you go back and you watch the original Ridley Scott Alien, and it's a different type of movie. For example, it's an amazing movie. It's a horror. You're talking about a horror thriller, a sci-fi horror thriller movie
versus an action genre
movie, which is the second one. Which is why everyone that watches it, similar to Back to the Future, which you watch that and it has all the elements of a movie that you love. Because it's action, it's got the Colonial Marines, it's got the cool tech and all the weapons and stuff like that, and it's about teams getting whittled around. Totally different movie, though, than the first one.
Yeah.
First one is very much about that psychological horror of being trapped in an enclosed environment with this thing that is fucking picking you off one by one, and there's nothing you can do to stop it except for blow up the ship. Like, that is the only thing you can do, right?
Yeah.
Which, hilariously enough, is the only thing they can do in the second one as well, is blow up the entire planet.
Spoilers, goddamn.
Oh, yeah, okay. I'm pretty sure
it was on my queue right after Daredevil. Once I get through this Daredevil.
If you've never seen Aliens, we're stopping the podcast right now. You need
to see Aliens.
And
in Aliens 3 was actually Fincher.
Yeah.
So what happened? Well, it was his first picture, I guess. You know,
well, it was his first picture, and now he didn't finish it, apparently, is the story goes.
He got fired.
No, they ran out of budget.
Ah.
And they were like, so all the effects, a lot of the effects you see for the alien are actually unfinished effects.
Really?
It's like running around. That's what I read something online about.
The guy in the suit,
that
in the dog suit.
Some BuzzFeed thing.
Yeah.
Things you didn't know, like the one article Nick read.
It's no, I mean, I got to be careful quoting stuff like that, because sometimes you'll read stuff on boards or someone will tweet something at you. You're like, I don't know.
You're just taking it from the Alien 3 subreddit, like the post. Fisher didn't finish the film.
No, but that was so devastating when that movie started, because they killed off Hicks. And you're like, why? Why wouldn't you just... It's Hicks. You wanted to see more Ripley and Hicks. Like, and Newt, for all intents and purposes, because, you know, eventually she was going to grow up and stop saying stupid shit. But yeah, that was just a weird direction to go. Did you see the tests they had, Neil Blomkamp did with Michael Biehn?
No.
So I don't know why he did it. I think it's for the new Alien that he's working on.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it's an alternate timeline thing or not. I have to read up on it a little bit. But they have makeup tests of him now with the burn face.
Well, remember, they're blinking out 3.
Yeah.
Oh, so it is.
It picks up from Aliens.
Yeah.
And then there's like none of that other shit happened.
So they're basically. Oh,
wow. Yeah. Which I love. What a great idea. Just to retcon it. Who cares? Fuck it.
Which is actually pretty fascinating if you think about it, because technically speaking, they could have been floating in space for that long and they would have aged. You know what I mean?
Unless they were in cryogenic sleep.
Well, they would have. Your body would still age, right? In cryogenics, like you would still.
No. Well, because they were in sleep chambers, right? Like they were when an alien.
No, you're frozen.
Kevin,
you're frozen.
Floating in space for like four.
Oh, right, and she was still 30. That's right.
Well, it took them that many years to get there.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was cool to see Hicks, to see Michael Biehn, like, you know, half his face melted off. It's still in the pads, like the badass, like Colonial Marine. Because, dude, when I was a kid, I would get, I tell this story all the time, but I'll tell it again because I love it. My dad used to get pissed at me because I would take all of his PVC pipe and cut it up with all of his duct tape. All this expensive duct tape and like electrical tape that he had gone and bought in Home Depot. My brother and I would saw it all up and we'd make the pulse rifle. And then we'd also make the smart gun.
Yeah.
And the smart gun was like, you're talking a shitload of fucking lights. Like, it's enough to like do an entire backyard with sprinkler systems. And my dad was like, who the fuck keeps using my dad is
was it really that hard for him to figure out?
No, because we've been running around
kids running around playing aliens
running around with duct tape on our shoulders, duct tapes on our head and shit like that. It was, you know, that was fun. I mean, that was one of those movies where I don't think I appreciated Alien until later in life.
Yeah,
I was like, oh, this is fucking slow, it doesn't, there's no cool guns and stuff.
That's
and
how I feel back about Back to the Future. It was the same way.
Yeah,
of like the original Back to the Future, I remember watching, you just, I, you know, as a what, 6-year-old, 7-year-old, 8-year-old, you can't connect with like what's happening in the 50s.
Well, no. One of the things that's amazing about the Back to the Future, if I'm not mistaken, it was the first time they shot two movies together. They shot Back to the Future 2 and 3 together.
Right.
And so they were shooting on the same sets at the same time, which was, so they're already planning on the success of 2 to shoot 3, I think that was the first time they did that.
They were doing, I think if I remember correctly, or if I'm right about this, they were originally, 3 was supposed to be part of 2.
Hmm.
It was supposed to be the middle act of 2. They were supposed to accidentally go back to the West. Yeah. And what I think, somewhere along the line, they were like, there's actually enough material here to make a third movie. And so it
to
got
make
greenlit.
The definitive Back to the Future movie.
Which, I mean, talk about being able to relate to a time period.
Yeah.
The Wild West, I'll tell you right now. I fucking wish I lived there.
Oh,
love dysentery.
Run for fun. That's a deep cut from Back to the Future 3, everybody.
But yeah, that was one of those things. I mean, they did a lot of cool stuff. That was you're talking that's what the 80s were so cool about, man. Like, you don't have CG back then. They had to do Zemeckis tells the story of when they were doing 2 about how they had the dinner set, right? And so you'd have to make sure you had a motion controlled camera that would shoot you here, then you here, then you here, and everything had to be like glued down. Because if someone screwed it up, all of a sudden in the split cut, it would be like like off, like half cut and stuff. Because it was just rotoed out. You're talking about like you know, and people having to cross over was that. I mean, that's like a team of people that have to work. I just screwed it up for them.
Yeah.
Like oh shit, now
slowly
back
out of the frame.
Yeah. So that was all really cool stuff and cutting edge at the time. You go back and look at it now, it's whatever. But let me ask you this question.
Sure, lay it on
me. What was the coolest piece of tech that you can remember from Back to the Future 2?
Hoverboard.
Not the hoverboard.
No, it's the garbage disposal engine.
That was pretty amazing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Mr. Fusion.
The thing that pops out to me.
Well, can I say mine or you want to answer your own question?
I thought you already said it.
You said not hoverboard. And I went, the pizza.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Nobody hydrates a pizza like you Grandma. Like, yeah. You could imagine how great that would be.
Yeah.
To have pizza like delivery, but at home. In a second. That's where genius. Is that technology? I want pizza that's not delivery, but tastes and looks like it.
Well, they're delivering by drone now in the Ukraine. Drones are delivering pizza in the Ukraine now.
Drones are going to be everywhere soon.
Yeah. We'll fly it in because maybe we shouldn't be driving.
Yeah.
I think flying it in, we're safer from the shelling.
We'll be safer if we bring it in that way.
Yeah.
So, okay,
but why are sequels sucky?
You can up it a little bit.
Because you're always chasing the ghost, right, of the original thing?
Red.
Yeah, and they're uninspired. So what they have is they have a brand that they need to make money on, and they have we need next Christmas or next summer, we're going to need another big one in 2 summers, and we don't have that, but we know Transformers, you know, a property that keeps on going. So write a script, and let's have that movie done by summer.
Right.
Now you have totally uninspired, driven by the need to have a movie rather than the need for a creator to make a movie,
right.
Which is an entirely different passion.
Well, this is like what you're talking about with Colin in Your Life today, right? Where it's like once you get this board of directors above you, they're the ones dictating what's happening, right? You're no longer
absolutely.
Just creating for yourself.
Absolutely.
Is that why you don't really make sequels? You exist in this odd world, but you keep
where it's
doing
all
different
kind of sequels,
things with it. Yeah.
Well, that was the idea. You know, I was actually I realized in games that. So I had come from Hollywood. We had come from filmmaking. I was at Rhythm and Hues. I was doing CG, you know, working on movies. And I'm trying to figure out where to tell stories and where to own stories. And I learned that the game industry didn't believe in sequels. Now, if you go back to the early 90s and you go, no, if you talk to a publisher and you say, I want to build this thing and it'll have sequels. You know, it's a property. They'd be like, yeah, you know, maybe Miyamoto can get away with that occasionally. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But really, sequels only sell 50% of the original, so we don't back it. And you were like, oh my God. To me, that was like Lucas's 1976 moment with Fox where they go, we just don't value licensing.
Yeah.
Right? And I was like, oh my God, like Tony Montana, this town's just waiting to get, you know. And and so that's how we started off with it's all about the IP, because we were like, well, no kidding, it's not really about the IP in games yet, because you're not investing in emotionally compelling characters, right? You just got characters that are the reason for canceling other characters.
Yeah, yeah.
You know. But they didn't understand sequels. So in gaming, I was like, wow, how do we create, you know, a property like Star Wars-ish where, you know the brand as soon as you see it.
Sure.
Hanna-Barbera, Looney Tunes, whatever it may be. The Muppets was a big inspiration. And then be able to create new content that's not necessarily a sequel, but at least has the brand familiarity.
Right.
And so that's what we were trying to do. And in the course of it, you could say it was sequels or not sequels. The truth is Abe's Exodus was a sequel because I wasn't planning on doing it. We did so good with Abe's Odyssey that they said, next 9 months, we need another one. Right. And that's your sequel. And we're like, I don't want to do it on that engine. They're like, do it. And, you have a partner. You got to be a good partner.
Yeah.
And But the industry did. I mean, that's amazing, right? You go back 20 years and the industry didn't believe in sequels. Now, what is it? It's a completely sequel-driven industry.
All sequels. Mm, yeah. You got a little bit of a IP and let's just milk that damn thing until it's dead.
Yeah.
And then let's place it in China because they're the ones that are paying for it and don't speak badly about the Chinese ever. No, I mean, that's what's crazy. You follow like what they just did with Transformers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where, I mean, that is Transformers is a movie franchise that's made to be like multiple films. Like, you have that. You're like, okay, we're going to make 40 of these. Just greenlit 20 of them. Let's go. But now they go, you know, they got into hot water with the Chinese because they were the ones that funded most of it. And they didn't show the hotel they were supposed to show. They didn't show the building they were supposed to show. Like, they fucked up. So they had to make goods, go back, reshoot stuff, make sure, like, the CG was different, things like that. It's a crazy world that we live out there. But that's kind of always the way it's been. I mean, I can't blame people. If we had a successful product, I would want to keep making that because it's easier to iterate than it is to create, right?
Absolutely, yeah. Iterate than innovate.
Yeah, innovate. That's what I think. That's the turn of phrase I was looking for.
Let me just correct you.
Thank you.
You
are the intellect. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think that I like where we're at now, where sequels aren't necessarily just shitty ripoffs of the movie that came before it. Now what we're seeing is sort of sagas, where we're seeing like, you know, especially with Marvel, where it's all building. They're all sequels, yes, and we're getting still Captain America 2, which we're like, do we really need that? But it's building toward a bigger story that they're trying to tell, and I can appreciate that because it hasn't been done before.
Well, that was brilliant.
Yeah, well, now it's done everywhere. Yeah. Like, you can't just do one sequel. It needs to be this universe.
You have your own universe.
Like, great Ghostbusters universe. Great Spider-Man universe.
Right.
Great X-Men. Like, there's just so many universes.
Well,
Universi.
But then you have, when they do a standalone story, that, yeah, it builds into the universe, but it doesn't necessarily build into it doesn't need to build into a main story thread like the Wolverine. You have a little more freedom. Then you can tell that side story because we know all these characters, right? You don't feel the need, like, the part of the problem with the original IP is we have to kind of tell the backstory every time you do anything, right? You have to get those audience members invested in that character. Mm-hmm. The best way to do that is, let's tell people some shit about this guy. Why is he flawed? What's his journey? Mm-hmm. What's he trying to accomplish? You know, or what are you trying to accomplish through him, right? He's the vehicle for that. He or she is the vehicle for that. It'd be cool.
I gotcha. I hear you.
That's
right. But yeah, that's what's fun now is, like, I was telling Greg about Daredevil. We watched that, and I was like, I don't need a Daredevil origin story, dude. I get it. He's got
But you're getting it. You know what I mean? Like,
We're getting it in sort of a way
a cool way. A different way.
It's a different way. It's a cool way. It's also a way that kind of builds into a bigger universe where he is a byproduct of what happened in Avengers. He, because the city was destroyed, left it sort of like there are these bigger crime syndicates that could just kind of have free reign, and he doesn't think that's okay.
Yeah.
So he's going to come in and do something about it. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, I forgot how Spider-Man got his powers, so I hope that they, like, go over that again when he comes to the Avengers.
They already said they're
Spider-Man.
Not going to. All
right, good.
So don't worry
he's
about
the one
it.
That got
I'm not worried. I'm concerned.
He's the one from Krypton. Or Spider-Tron.
What was Spider-Tron?
Spider-Tron.
Spider-Tron, yeah.
Spider-Tron?
Yeah.
That's the name of the planet he's from?
A good movie, a good sequel to Kenny Char's real question, Spider-Man 2.
Yeah.
Spider-Man 2 was better than the original Spider-Man, Sam Raimi.
Yes.
Which one was the one? And I hear that
that's the original. Will save us. I'm not going to stand here and wait.
Every podcast, I don't know if you noticed that I do
that. I'm watching her, watching
I try watching to get. I have this little game I play in my brain of how quickly can I get Greg to sing a song with me.
Oh, it's,
and it happens instantaneously.
I got the musical urge. There's nothing
you do have
I can't
the urge.
Stop. Can't be
and
stopped.
Splurge.
Dark Knight's an easy answer, too.
Oh, that's a really good answer.
Yeah. Dark Knight.
Yeah. That is not even a sequel. That's
yeah, it
just
is.
Like a,
but it is.
I mean, it is, but it's like, dude, come, just... Come correct.
I feel like,
yeah, come fix this train wreck for us that we've like ran into the ground with that. What was that last one?
Dark Knight Rises.
No, the one before
the
Dark
Joel
Knight.
Schumacher.
Yeah, the Joel Schumacher. Robin, like, Robin, what was that? That was like the art direction was almost as bad as Speed Racer, which is
what?
Untoppable.
I love Speed Racer.
Right. So the art direction. So you know, it's probably
the movie.
Yeah.
One.
Yeah.
I love that shit.
You're a child.
Yeah.
You were a child.
Dude, it was fucking. Yeah. No, I wasn't a child. It was
so
awesome.
Obviously you're not the art director.
Yeah, I don't know.
See, that's wait, okay. What? That's okay. You can enjoy the movie, but it had the worst art direction on the planet in the history of film, actually.
No way! Yeah. I thought it was cool.
Yeah. In the history
I thought
of
it was
film.
Really cool.
Yeah,
I don't know. I like.
No,
that.
I mean, if you tried to art direct something worse, you couldn't. You can't.
I don't
succeed.
Know, man.
I mean, I agree with you, but I want to hear why that is the case from your brain, from a person who has made that his career.
Well, I mean, just the, I mean the idea of. Like Burning Man color scheme for general fashion and outlook, like actually works at Burning Man, but not in a futuristic setting.
Right.
So every color palette possible is thrown at every scene. It's so gaudy, right? It's like looking at, you know, there are cool looking lowriders and then there are tasteless looking lowriders and paint jobs, right? It's like in the tasteless class.
Yeah.
So every scene, if you go back and you look at it, the depth, the atmosphere, the color schemes, the believability of the green screen, the compositing, all these things, they're just not there. We were watching it like, how could these guys ever have been involved with Matrix?
Yeah.
How could that have happened? And then they release that clusterfuck of color and light up there, right? Which is just
I like that though.
Terrifying.
It felt different. Like it felt like that.
Well,
it was
yeah.
such a unique experience. It literally was like an explosion of colors. It felt like a cartoon, but with real people. More so than a lot of the other, like when they try to do that.
It just wasn't how I received it.
Okay.
You know, well, I mean, it was an explosion of colors.
Yeah, it definitely was.
I mean, everything's relative, right? I mean,
yeah.
His experience is going to be different because you're a different place in your life with different experiences coming into it. Tim, I think, does. I could see why you would like that movie because that was the choice. It was a choice to make something that was so over the top, like basically like a visual.
It was
LSD
a YouTube
trip,
thumbnail
right?
of the movie.
Like, that was the whole point.
But those are good.
Yes, right? Fair enough.
Like you know, I mean, that was like what was it? What was the movie in the afterlife where
in Beetlejuice?
No. Williams.
The Robin
beautiful
Williams.
What Dreams May Come. I think
it was no, it wasn't that because was it what Dreams May Come? Okay, like that was like an acid trip, right?
Yeah.
Everything's actually moving. Yeah. I mean, not that I would ever know, but I've heard.
No, yeah,
and it looked just like
sure,
it,
sure,
you know.
Sure.
But it looked just like it. whereas like Speed Racer was like a bad meth trip or something. You know?
I mean, that was my issue a lot with Transformers too. Was like I had a designer put it in context for me. I was like, I couldn't pinpoint why I didn't like the design of the actual Transformers.
Yeah.
Because in the old school, you remember the old school Transformers were just boxes basically because they had to be because they had to animate them in such a way that it was quick
because the toys really
everything was economical about it.
Yeah.
It was a very economical workflow and a very economical way to make toys. So you get to these new Transformers and I was like, what is it that I'm having a problem with? And one of my designers that I GM was like,
racist.
No, they're not racist, Greg.
Oh, there's not, robot heaven.
Not everything is racist, and maybe robots do have a heaven. They were sentient life forms. No, he said there's no place for your eye to rest, and he's like, in design,
yeah, that's right.
You have to design things so that there's a place for your eye to sort of that draws your eye that we can rest on, and that way you're not constantly trying to find. Like your brain's not trying to unscramble what this mass of shit is in front of you.
Which is kind of like his directing in general.
Brad's 100% like that. Although I won't speak badly of the man himself because I'm terrified of him.
Of
Michael Bay.
Michael Bay, yeah.
No,
yeah.
He hears stories about that guy. You're like, I don't ever want to work with him. But
No.
It's funny because I was talking a bunch in front of people and he'll walk away.
Oh, that poor guy.
I was out at Singapore at FZ. The Feng Zhu School of Design. He designed some of the Transformers for Michael Bay in the first movie or two. And he goes, yeah, it was really cool. You know, Michael Bay's calling me on Sunday to work on the shit. And he goes, it's not so cool the fourth time he's calling on fucking Sunday. Feng, who's a great designer, you know. But anyway, yeah, that's totally right on. Where do you look? And it's similar with the pacing. You know, like if you saw the Legos movie, right? The kids love it, but there's zero pacing. It starts off at 6,000 RPMs and it ends at about 7,000 RPMs and it never slows down.
That was,
you know, it's just right. There's no pace, so it's totally a Ritalin generation focus.
I watched that film after everyone that I know saw it said it was fantastic. I would love it, and you just pinpointed why I didn't like it, and I couldn't put it into words until you just. Yeah. I couldn't put it better myself. Tim and I argued about it. I didn't argue. We had a discussion of why you liked it versus I didn't like it. And I think that was it. It was tailored toward people that don't necessarily have my older attention span.
Yeah.
I'm trying not to insult you, Tim.
Oh, no. I mean, the movie has issues, and like pacing is one of the issues.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also, like, a lot of it is just here's references to things you like.
Yeah.
Here's more references. But it's like, I like references.
And the song is awesome. Everything is awesome. That was just like everyone singing.
Thank God. I love when songs get really popular because I like hearing them over and over and over and over on everything. I especially liked when they did it like in the Academy Awards and you're like, what is this head trip dance number they're doing to this song right now? Which was freaky deaky. It's interesting to watch you bring up the Wachowski siblings. It's interesting to watch their career.
Yeah.
Because they did The Matrix, which was fantastic. Yeah. And really nothing. Well, Bound was good too.
Bound was good. Well, that came before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
After The Matrix, everybody was like, this is it. Let's see what they do next.
And then what was the other one?
They just made Jupiter Ascending, which was the movie that just came out, came and went.
Didn't. So I expect that to go nowhere. But what was the other one they made after
Speed Racer?
Speed Racer was...
Kev, look it up.
It's a brand name, isn't it?
Atlas Shrugged.
Not Atlas Shrugged.
Cloud Atlas?
Cloud Atlas.
Was it Cloud Atlas?
I'm confusing the Ayn Rand, sorry. But that was incomprehensible as well.
I think that was largely a retelling of the book, too.
It's not a book. It's a fucking movie. You know? Let's make it comprehensible in a two-hour movie. Mm-hmm. And it was like so all over the place.
Oh, man. Were you a fan of The Matrix when it came out?
Absolutely. Still one of the greatest movies made, I think, personally.
Then, do you remember seeing the second one? That was one of those times... Yeah. On par with the new Star Wars trilogy that came out, and I was like, "Oh no!"
Yeah, what happened?
Oh no!
Why didn't they give it to the original creators? Don't!
Oh, shit! They did. that was one of those. As a kid, like, I guess maybe I was just sheltered, or I just had blinders on. Like, I just chose the movies that I liked, and that everything else was like, whatever. I don't think about it again. But then when they got to The Matrix 2, and Star Wars, and you're like, "Oh, these are bulletproof. They're never going to screw these up." And the second one, you're like.
They screwed it up.
Wow. This was just not even good. It was bad. It just wasn't like, dude, it just wasn't. You know what I mean?
It was the guys with the dreadlocks, though.
So if you look at like how those films were made, right? And the Matrix 1 was, I heard Terry Semel say in a meeting once, and he used to run Warner for 20 years, CEO at Warner, and he's the one who apparently greenlit the picture. But in his mind, he said, we never greenlit the picture because I never really understood it. We just kept on giving it more money until it was kind of done. Mm-hmm. Now, people will argue and say that that wasn't the case, but at least that's what he said about it back when. And the thing was that they were passing around that script, and they said, first of all, we want Hollywood to understand when they were going to studios. No one under 30 is going to understand this script. But it's totally going to resonate with the under 30 audience. So that was what they were saying, right? And Terry Summers was like, yeah, I didn't get it. Like, it didn't make any sense to me, but these guys were really passionate about it. So you have this thing where you've got these guys that are like, we need to tell this philosophical story about the fucking world we're living in and about how we engage it and how what the youth today is realizing that we live in a matrix, right? We're going to tell this and we're going to layer it with all this existential philosophy and spiritualism and all these things, and we're going to bring you a new type of Star Wars experience. That's my summary of a soundbite, right?
Yeah.
And it makes Matrix 2 is, okay, guys, that film was such a hit. You got four times the amount of money and half the time, go get us another one, right? So now you got, shit, how do we build on it? It's not entering with the same passion, the same need to tell a story. They say that it never would have been that if you talked to John Gaden, those guys that were over on the island on Alameda doing the effects. And they'll talk about how, because it was small budget, because it was off the radar and it wasn't being done in Hollywood typically shot in the same old lots with the same old politics, same old bureaucracies, they were able to sort of do it in a vacuum and just go for it like it was a student picture, you know, like it was a student film. They were able to go for it in an indie-like way. And after that, boom, now you've got $120, $140 million budget. Give us number two. Give us number three. Mm-hmm. And those they started shooting at the same time together, too, right?
Yeah,
those ended with the trailer to three, right?
Just like Back to the Future 2.
Did it?
And three.
I think that's actually true.
That's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
With the train? I remember when I first saw the... Back to the Future for the first time. I was at Kevin's house, and when it ended and it said to be continued and the motherfucker flies off, holy shit.
Yeah.
That was the coolest thing in the world. A movie said to be continued?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I always loved that. They used to do that with the old Bond films. If you watch to the end, it said Bond will return in On Her Majesty's Secret Service or whatever the next movie, because they, you know, they knew they were going to make
it
afterward. Which I was like, obviously watching them, I'm like, well, I know because I've seen all of them. I've seen, I have the box set VHS, but can you imagine at the time you're in theaters and you're like, that was a really cool movie, and then Bond will return, 007 will return in Her Majesty's Secret Service. Like, dope. Can't wait for that one.
Yeah.
See that in 2 years. That's dope.
I think part of the reason sequels don't work, pan out, and it's what we're talking about with like Lego Movie in particular, and the fact that like it's expectation, right? Like people, I didn't get around to seeing Lego Movie till after everybody had seen it and said it was the best thing in the world. And then I went and saw it, and I was like, oh, it was fine. It was good. I don't think it didn't catch me off guard.
I couldn't get to the end.
Once it gets, when something catches you off guard, that's good. I feel like there's like, holy shit, like Matrix. I remember when they brought Matrix to me, the original, I just bought a PS2. My friend's like, you need to understand what DVD's all about, and gave me that, and we watched it on my tube TV with speakers. Like, oh my God, you can hear the shell casings hit the ground. Yeah.
It was still NTSC.
Yeah, exactly. It's like then from then on, right? My expectations for the second Matrix are amazing, you know. So it's the opposite of what we're talking about with Batman v Superman, right? Like Man of Steel, I had such high expectations, and it totally fell flat. And I'm like, all right, now I get what the universe is. So Batman, Superman, with that expectation level, I'm excited, and hopefully they'll, you know, hop over it and be amazing. That's the problem with sequels.
Yeah. We've gone long on this topic. I could talk about this for the next hour now.
All right, fine, then we'll stop. Tim.
Yes.
What's your topic?
All right, so there was some issues that happened last week. Got some real, real deep issues that occurred.
An issue. There was like a what issue.
There was a couple issues, but there's one specific issue that I had. So Colin's not here, which means we weren't allowed to shoot in this house.
Right.
So we had to go to Kevin's
house. That's a bit of a generalization. So Colin wasn't here.
Colin and Greg
weren't
here.
And I weren't here.
Yeah.
So we didn't want two people not just bumming around the house in case our landlord comes by and says, what's going on, strangers?
All right, whatever.
We had to go to Kevin's house. I just wanted you to know that. Hmm? We were going to wear no pants the entire time if you let us in.
I'm sure. I can only imagine. I've seen what you do to the bathroom when we are here. I can only imagine what would happen when we're not here.
Look, don't criticize my bowel movements.
Okay.
Thank you.
This is disgusting, but I'm going to say it anyways. Earlier today, I went to pee. Someone didn't flush. And I don't know who it was, but it was a mess in there.
Jesus.
I was like, well, that's fun. That's just, why would you not do that? It was one of us. I know it was one of us. Anyways, so.
I hope it wasn't me.
No, we were locked down in here the whole day.
Things are happening. So we were at Kevin's house, right? And we're just chilling there. We're doing stuff. Then I just got my new car. So I got my license plates in the mail, and I can't do anything by myself. So I'm like, Kevin, can you put my license plates on my car?
You just need a screwdriver.
Yeah, I know, but I don't have screwdrivers. He has a screwdriver on him at all times.
Is that true?
And a knife. A giant, like a
I know the knife part. I didn't know he had the
This whole, like, tool. It does
the
all
Leatherman? What the hell is that? Is that like a Swiss Army knife? But
yeah.
Not racist? Remember the thing I threw at him yesterday? Oh, right. When you open the blade.
It's an all-in-one tool, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So he's putting my license plate on, and I take the, like, envelope it comes with, and I go to throw it away. And we're outside, and there's this, like, recycling bin. Someone's recycling bin, one of the blue bins.
We're in a neighborhood, like, yeah.
All right, fine. I'm just going to put it in there because it's a freaking envelope.
Yeah.
So I do that shit, and I go to walk away. The dude who owns it screams at me from the window, and he's just like, Nick, can you?
He was like, hey, nah, homie. That ain't cool. That ain't cool, dog. And Tim's like, first of all, we didn't know where it was coming from. Second of all, it was at that moment that I noticed there was a cable chain from the pole to the trash can. So this guy is deadly fucking serious about his trash. Like, he does not want you messing with
like, it was literally tied down. Like,
yeah.
With one of those, like, what are those things called, Kevin? The, like, lock cable?
It was like a bike cable, like a bike
cable. Yeah, like,
a bike lock.
This is some legit shit. And, like,
which means trash cans are getting stolen in that neighborhood, which suck.
That's right.
I don't know about
who would think that Kevin lives in a bad neighborhood? The corpse molester.
No. I don't know, man. Like, no one else has this shit. This guy's. It was just the whole thing where I'm like, wow, this is some real serious shit. And there was nothing in that recycling bin. And it was a giant recycling bin.
Okay.
So then I'm like, what, do you want me to take it out? And he's just like, you got to take it. It was not a normal one. It was one of the giant ones.
It was a normal size one.
No, it was like the XL one.
All right. They don't make a small recycling.
Yeah, they do. I have one of the small ones.
Oh, you have one of the little pony ones.
Well, not the pony ones, but it's definitely.
Welcome to San Francisco, everybody.
No. Anyways. So, I had to freaking reach in and get this thing, and I couldn't reach, because it was, like, all the way in there.
I would have just tipped it over and dumped it all out. Was there anything in there other than your
thing? I couldn't
tip
it over, because it's tied down to the goddamn pole.
Yeah. I just would have shrugged and be like, I tried, man.
Well, here's the thing. I would have done that, except for the fact that it had my name on the envelope.
Yeah.
It was that was stupid.
And all my stuff. So I was like, well, fuck. So anyway, that was that experience. The reason I bring up that story is recycling is some real serious shit to people. Now, going through this whole experience, I was just like, all right. Why did he care so much? Why is this a thing? It was a freaking envelope. He even came down afterwards to like check if there's anything in there. God damn it, dude. Now,
could you have taken this guy in a fight?
No. Absolutely not.
Okay.
Not a chance in fucking hell. He's a big guy. Yeah. So my whole thing was, I was like, why does he care so much? Like, why is this a thing? I was like, well, maybe if I was like rummaging, like he heard it. So like he thought I was like trying to take his stuff. And I get people wouldn't want you to take their garbage because like if you're a celebrity and you have like, you know, celebrity poop and you can sell this shit on eBay. Mm-hmm. Like, I get that. I get that. But I was like, why if I'm putting something like, it's not like it was, I was putting, if I came out with a giant bag of shit and put it in your car, so, in your thing, I would totally get that.
It's called a slippery slope. If he doesn't stop you, then you think it's okay. And then you do start bringing by, and then you bring by a bottle. And then you buy, you know, the little McDonald's bag. And then it's a garbage bag. And then it's all of your.
Yeah, but it's not on the street, so everyone should be a little more grateful.
Yeah. Sure. He was like, nah, homie, you got your own. You live over there. It's like, I don't live over there. So,
well,
I'm just on the street right now.
What's funny is it was convenient because you were like, damn it. And you took it out and then you walked the exact distance from the car the other way and threw it out in Kevin's trash.
Yeah, to the trash that was like well hidden like a normal person does when it's not trash day.
That's true.
Like not tied up to a freaking pole for everyone to see.
When I was doing productions in LA, that was a huge issue because if you do anything in downtown LA, you have to rent a dumpster. So like mm-hmm. in production land, you have to get a dumpster, all that stuff, arrange mm-hmm. a pickup, all that stuff, especially if you're out of shoot for more than 3 days, like a mm-hmm. giant film crew produces a lot of garbage. Mm-hmm. And when you're on an independent shoot that doesn't feel like doing that, what do you do? Well, you have all these bags. So you either A, put them in your car and drive them to the dumpster or drive them to the dump, or B, walk to the nearest dumpster you can find that's not locked down and put them in there.
Be as shady
as
possible.
It's actually illegal. Like, yeah. You can get a serious fine if you do that.
Yeah.
Because of that, because people have to pay to have their trash taken away in the big dumpsters and things like that. I don't know what this guy's specific problem with it was, other than I think he just was watching you do it and felt that it was a little bit disrespectful to use someone else's trash can. I don't know why, though. I don't think you pay by the poundage. But people in San Francisco get pissed about that. If you actually do it in San Francisco, get that out of there.
Trash gets picked up every Monday. When I walk Portillo on Sunday night and he poops and I pick up his little poop in a bag, I pass dozens of trash cans I could toss it in, but I don't tell him at my trash can because I'm not going to deal with something like this. Because this happens more than you think. Neighborhood people. I fought off the devil. I'm sorry.
You won.
I almost sneezed. Thank you. Oh, okay. It's about time.
I was really confused at what the hell just happened.
People in San Francisco are weird about this. And people in general are weird about that. Every neighborhood has its weird idiosyncrasies about all these stupid things that you don't do or can do, or the one guy over there is like the guy across the street. Have we talked about Red Zone guy?
No.
There's a Red Zone guy in my neighborhood. And so like
he's always in a Red Zone?
No. His curb ends and it's red. And so he repainted it red and then put up reflectors all over the pole and put up his own sign that this is a red zone right here. And so we can fit the Mini Cooper in there with the bumper like a little bit over the thing. And this guy has dealt with his red zone so many fucking times. He has printouts of a note he wrote with his shaky hand that says something like, "Dear neighbor, please stay out of my," and then it's red zone in quotes or whatever. And he puts it under your windshield wiper like a psychopath. And he'll do it to people all the time. And it's just like, dude, it's not even blocking your driveway. Calm down. But like, that's his fucking thing. He will sit in a lawn chair in his driveway to protect that red zone. It's like, he never parks
these
there.
People, man. They're freaking crazy.
No, you know what it is? It's the city. Like, does it to you. Because I am one of those people. Because I live in a place where there is no red painting. No,
yeah.
So people think it's
the bottom of it.
They go, my garage spot is just big enough for me to pull my car in, and I have one of the garages that goes underneath my building, but the spot to the opening to get into it is very, very narrow. And so oftentimes what happens is you can fit three cars here and one car here if they're small cars. But what happens is these two cars, if they get just a little bit bigger, I have to come in at a 90 degree angle. So I have to reroute myself all the way up the street and come down and then go, oh, make a nice wide turn and come in. Well, there have been times when I go, it's physical impossible. I can't pull my car into the spot. So now after a long day of work, maybe it's Friday and maybe I just want to go home and like watch Daredevil, I can't do that. I have to go find parking in San Francisco.
Like a nobody.
Have you ever tried? You don't drive much. I finding parking in San Francisco is the most nerve-wrackingly like anger-inspiring experience you will ever have in your life.
Absolutely. This is why I ride a bike.
Oh, that, it's a perfect absolutely. Reason
in fact,
to ride
when
a
I,
motorcycle.
Speaking of which, when I parked in front of your house legally, your couple next door came out because I could tell they're like, who's parking so close to our car? And
right.
It's like, sorry.
Yeah.
I'm allowed to do this.
Yeah,
you
yeah,
know,
yeah.
Nicely. But there, you can tell they're like getting all uptight. Someone might be parking. There's only space for one. No, it's space for one and a bike.
Yeah.
But it's always parking.
If I rode that bike that you were riding, yeah. I would be very careful where I parked it. Because people in San Francisco just do not have respect for a fine motorcycle.
Yeah.
And if I came back and like came out and found that thing on the ground, yeah. I would rage on whatever. I would just pick the car nearest to it. Fucking rage yeah. on it.
You know, I've been lucky. I never had a problem.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're probably pretty smart about where you're parking. I've seen people like that have bikes they don't care about, especially like Knob Hill,
yeah,
where they're parking it like on a steep incline where you and know that car in front of it's like the guy's gonna release, boom, and then
yeah,
I don't know what that was,
yeah,
gone. You've never seen that car
yeah,
again.
That's right.
So I used to see guys every morning, not every morning, but like once a week, you'd come out and you'd see a bike on the ground, or you'd see someone
yeah,
like the bike would be up, but the windshield would be fucked yeah. up, and people would be pissed yeah. off.
Yeah. But it's always there's always parking.
Yeah,
that's the thing. You're always on time.
Yeah,
you're always parking.
Yeah, yeah. Now the thing about the cool. recycling in particular in funny. San Francisco is something I'd never experienced growing up in the Midwest like a normal person. But coming here into the city, where at night, when not even at night, but usually like dusk on Sunday night before trash night, you'll hear there's a conversation with Colin where we stop so we can reference it. But you hear the clang clang of bottles
mm-hmm.
because people just roam the streets, open the recycling bins, open the bags, go through, pick up bottles, they take apart your recycling bin and then put it back together sans the glass.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
So that brings me to the actual topic.
We weren't at the topic yet. No. I thought it was recycling bins. I apologize.
Well, I mean, it is, but it's those people. So this whole dilemma that I went through, I couldn't sleep that night. I'm just thinking about all these recycling conundrums and all this stuff.
At any point, did you think about going back, filling it with concrete?
Not concrete, but fecal matter, yes. And Nick made sure I didn't do that.
That's good.
Yeah. I wasn't actually going to do it, but like I was so upset at this whole thing happening. I was just like, and I know I couldn't because like they know where Kevin lives.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And like, we had to come back the next day to record the show.
And all that stuff too, but it's just like.
And you don't have a chance of Hill beating his ass.
No, that too.
That guy would have beat all three of us
but,
to death and gone out and got a hamburger and not even giving a shit about it.
Four homicides on yeah. one piece of recycled garbage.
Yeah, but so my topic is the people that, because in SF, I grew up here my whole life and it's just a normal thing. That you see these older people walking around, just collect all day and all night. It's not just during Sunday nights. It's all times of the day. Walking up to every single garbage can and having these bags and bags and bags of bottles and cans.
Yeah.
And they're just like walking with them. There's just little old ladies like holding pounds and pounds of these bags.
Yeah,
and
they got
like,
a muni with them. They got
yeah,
a muni with their
oh,
giant
God,
trash bags.
That's like a whole other thing. It's rigmarole. Like, well, great. You just took up half the bus with your goddamn bags.
Your smelly ass bottles.
Yeah. Hands. What do they do this for?
They sell
money.
They
money,
sell
you
them.
Say. Money, yeah. money, money. Do you know how many freaking bottles you need to get a dollar? 20.
Yeah.
They're 5 cents.
Yeah.
20.
Yeah.
Think of how much you can get a day. If you have a jackpot day and you're just like nailing it and you're like bags and bags and bags, what are you making? $10 for a whole day of work?
So think what? About that old lady, how hard she's working carrying those
yes.
bags. Why?
For $10?
For $10 that might feed her tonight.
No, no. Okay, here's the thing.
Yeah.
I understand that I might be being culturally like an asshole right now and all that shit. I want someone to explain to me why I think it'd be a better use of her time to make a lemonade stand. I bet you that she will get more than $10 selling goddamn lemonade than working her ass off doing that.
But she would need a license, she would need to pay the city, and she would need
insurance. She's not allowed to steal people's bottles.
Well, but they're not stealing, they're recycling.
Yeah.
No, but if I'm not allowed to put a freaking envelope in someone's recycling bin, you're definitely not allowed to steal.
Yeah, but you can't let the asshole set the law, right? And so to the guy who's like, don't use my garbage can, you're like, okay, so you'd feel better if the garbage was on the street than in your precious can. Like, that's kind of, you know, he's got some mm-hmm. issues, right? And it's another thing if you come out every week and your garbage is full because
someone else
put it there. That's yeah. a different issue, mm-hmm. you know. But the old people grabbing the bags, I mean, I remember it's happening in our neighborhood and they drive by and they do it. And what we started doing is we started separating out the bottles so they could grab them. Because Sherry, she's looking at that. And one one night she sees someone's in the garbage, and so she's a little upset, like, why are they there? And then she goes out, and it's an old person digging through to get the bottles. Now she comes back in the house, and she's crying, because she's like, old people shouldn't have to do this. You know, and ever since Reagan, we got a whole issue there of dumping all the crazy people that should have had help into
the streets. We'll cut mental health.
Yeah, you know, I mean, as we increase the defense budgets, we'll keep on cutting social needs, you know, because we're such a poor country, you know?
Yeah, you got to pick and choose.
Yeah, which is pretty pathetic. But, make sure we take. I mean, just think about it. Like, I think, like, when I see young people panhandling, the question is, are they working or are they they don't have a green card? Like, what's the issue? And then you do a guess on whether you're going to help them or not, right?
Right.
When you see old people, it's almost like no matter what crimes they might be guilty of, if it's a 70-year-old lady who's carrying all these bags for nickels on the pound, right, what's going on there? And to me, it's like that's a sad thing. So I look at it, I don't have the same reaction. I look at it, I always have a sad reaction because I'm like, God damn, man, to look at these old people, like, how can this country be so rich? And this is what we have happened to our old people. Like, for example, and we don't talk about it, what's the highest suicide rate in the United States? Mm. It's the elderly.
Really?
We don't talk about it because they're just offing themselves regularly, right? Like higher than teens, way, right? So these things we just don't talk about, but what's happening? So Social Security gets cut, you know, all these things get hammered. All the expenses are going up,
70,
up,
and then
nothing
like,
is getting cheaper.
How am I
going
to live? Right, yeah.
And then these old people are winding up very disposable. So to me, it's kind of, you know, but I'm a bleeding heart, you know, tree hugger.
I get that, and I do understand that I'm me and I,
no,
Tim
I think
and I talk about
I think your question is not necessarily is it morally or ethically right to go through people's garbage to recycle. Your question is more like, is there nothing else? These people are clearly motivated. If you're motivated enough to go through someone's garbage to make a living, you're good enough to work in the workforce. And
if
so
there's
what
a job.
If there's a job.
Yeah.
But the question I think the thing that is the issue is maybe they're illegal, maybe they can't work in this country legally, or they have a criminal record and they can't get a job,
or they're mentally handicapped.
In which case, this is all they're functionally capable of doing. Or
it's their day off; they're getting a different shift, something along that.
Right. Or they're just doing it because it makes a little extra money on their day off. Like I've seen guys, like I was telling you sit at bars on Union Street. If you're there till 2 o'clock in the morning, you'll see a big truck pull up, and he'll go through the garbage. And this is we're talking like a steak bed truck that's just got hundreds of bags of these things in there. And I'm like, well, this is this guy's industry. Like he figured it out that if he has this route, it'll take him 2 hours and he'll probably make a few $100 and that's it. And that's his work for the day maybe. And then tomorrow morning he goes and does his other job. And then after that he does his other job. And then at 2 o'clock in the morning he does this job. Because that's what you'll see a lot of times in these older like communities where, especially in the Chinese community where you see like the parents, and like there's three generations living in the same house, is that like they all keep working. So the grandfather would be like, well, I can't work anymore really, but
I can go do this.
I can go do this, and I can contribute to my household still.
It's one of those things. Colin and I have talked about it when we'll hear it happening or whatever, and Colin used to be super obsessive about it, and he'd hear it, and then he'd just go out there and watch. He'd just go to the window and watch and just not say anything. He wasn't trying to stop him. He was just fascinated by the practice of what was happening. But the argument we kept coming back to, right, is like, it must be worth it. You know what I mean?
But
they're making enough money in their head that this is worth it. I don't know what it's doing.
If they can get $10 a day, they can eat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In 2013, by the way,
about this that doesn't add up.
At least in 2013, SF Gate reports that it is illegal.
Yes,
it's always been illegal. No, to throw something out in someone's garbage.
It also it's
no. This is no. He's talking. They're
garbage.
Calling it. It's
well, it's not stealing if it's garbage.
Yes, it is.
Why?
No, it's technically the second it goes on the curb, it's public domain.
No, not if it's in your garbage can.
No,
the second Greg's reading right now.
The second you put your garbage out on the curb, you are releasing your. The second it's garbage, I believe the law says you are releasing all of your ownership over that garbage. That's why and
pretty
people.
Sure that's incorrect.
No,
I mean, like, guys,
we
live in San Francisco, and I'm reading the SF Gate story.
What's it say?
Each week in San Francisco and in urban neighborhoods across the Bay Area, residents dutifully separate aluminum cans, glass bottles, and plastic jugs from their garbage and roll their recycling bins to the curb on trash day. But before the garbage trucks can arrive, many bins are picked clean by people who take the bottles and cans to a recycling center or a wholesale black market collector on the corner and turn the trash into cash. The practice is illegal and inflates garbage collection rates. The thieves often leave behind a mess on city sidewalks. But police in San Francisco, Oakland, and other Bay areas told the Chronicle Watch that although they understand residents' annoyances with the recycling ripoffs, chasing down thieves is not a high priority.
He stole my garbage!
chasing down thieves. Can you guys just imagine?
I can't believe they use the term thieves. You know, they're mirroring
right?
your.
Yeah. A man who would only identify himself as Pretzel said he collects bags of bottles and cans from residential blue bins most nights. He makes a few bucks each day and tries not to leave a mess because that just, quote, gets people all upset, he said. Pretzel said he's been hassled by the cops for taking recycling only once in his 5 years in San Francisco. One guy shined his light at me once and told me to go somewhere else. But that's it, man.
There you go. See, I'm a schemey fuck. If there's something I can scheme, I do it. If there's money I can make, I do it.
You do it.
And like this goes back to like me in high school and shit, when obviously things like this crossed my mind many times where I was like, can I profit off of this? Like, how can I do this? Mm-hmm. And like, I'm addicted to soda. You guys know this. Mm-hmm. There was a point in my life where I was like, I'm just going to like keep all my cans. I'm going to do this. And like, I got a shit ton of cans. Like mountains of cans in my garage, and I went and turned it in. I was like, I'm gonna be fucking rich, and I was not. I think I made like $15.
That's why you gotta
like,
stamp
that's
them into the
flat. Months.
Like, oh, it's like the just... episode of Seinfeld where they get the truck to go back and get him in Vermont or whatever. It's still illegal according to San Francisco.
Can you check and see if trash is like the ownership laws on trash? Because that's always not on whether or not it's.
But I think
you can pick through someone's trash because that's actually just like that's a law that's just vandalism. But do you own your trash if you put it out? Because there were reports back in the day that reporters would go through people's trashes and find like bank statements and shit and record on that stuff.
I put in do you own your trash? Google autofill puts in do you throw away your own trash at Panera?
I want to see.
I really want to know the answer to that.
Say scheming fuck on.
Oh,
that'd be
great.
That'd be great.
I'm so good at that.
Title: scheming fuck.
Yeah, that would be Tim's title. That's actually Tim's official title. Kind of funny.
Nice.
But okay, going.
Once you put something
though,
out in the trash, do you still own it? This is from Slate.com. Probably not. Items discarded in the trash are often classified as abandoned property, meaning the owner has relinquished his claim, I should say his or her claim to the items and doesn't intend to.
Well, women don't throw away things, Greg. Fact. They're not capable of it. They can just cook.
Jesus Christ. Dude.
Light
I'm
that
being
fire.
Sarcastic. I'm teasing. They can,
we know.
They can make kids too.
Yeah, I got in a big argument with this guy.
Just
he's
joking.
He's running a crappy Chinese food place in Berkeley. And I walked into a store and I looked at him. I waited for him to look at me. And then I was like, okay, I'm tossing this in your garbage. He goes, no. And he runs out there. Like I was like, dude. First of all, calm down. Like this little guy comes running out like he's going to do something, right? So that was kind of funny anyway. But then it's like, hold on a second, dude. Your shitty wrappers are all over this city block.
Yeah.
Right? Now, those are winding up in someone else's garbage cans. You don't give a shit. Now, if someone's coming to you with garbage that would wind up on the street, you should be honored to put it in your fucking can. You know, like, come on, man. This is the neighborhood. Keep it clean. Like, if I'm the type of person, I walk down the street. If I'm able, I'll pick up shit on the way and I'll throw it in the next garbage can, right? Because I think if everyone did that, the world would be pretty spotless.
Right,
aside from where they want to dump chemical waste, but that's another issue, you know. But it's like, this is something occasionally, you know, Sherry and I get in these little arguments, and I try to come back to it. I go, don't let someone else's pettiness define your standards. You know, like when the guy next door is giving you shit about using his garbage can, and you feel like you need to start doing that too, it's like, that's the slippery slope of bullshit.
Right.
It's like, you know, man, don't let them lower your standards, you know?
Yeah, see, the only reason I would do that, I mean, granted, my trash is in a building that's enclosed, so you can't get to it unless you live in the building.
So that's why it's not an issue with you.
But that would, it would freak me out if someone was there throwing trash. I'm like, how the hell did you get in this building? But B, for me, we have a 16-unit building that has a trash can.
Oh.
So
what?
Inevitably.
Like a dumpster?
Like a normal like roll-out trash can. So guess what?
What the fuck does that work?
Every Monday, it doesn't. There's overflowed trash, and sometimes they just don't pick it up because they have that quote-unquote law. Like, if it's not in the bin, I'm not going to pick it up.
How do you do that? I mean, we live in one house with two people, and this guy has three cans out there.
It's disgusting, first of all. And secondly, we have a recycle bin that I swear to God. And
holds a six-pack.
No, it's the same size as the trash can, but the problem is like people order stuff. Everyone orders stuff now.
Right.
So everything comes in a box within a box.
Right.
So you're not just ordering toilet paper. It comes in a box within a box within a box that's like this big, but then it's like for like one roll of toilet paper.
And you're ordering toilet paper wrong, man.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just using that as an example, of course. But the thing that kills me is that no one understands the concept of breaking down one's box.
Yeah.
And that pisses me off because I love doing it, first of all. It's a huge stress relief.
Yeah.
And I like the idea of like I can take all this with the proper planning and fit it into all in this little
it's
tiny
like
square.
Of
I'm like shoving things in, making stints.
Right.
So that I can make the thing bigger. you know, so that when they wheel it out, they can't fold the thing, but they can still, like, yeah, it's still in like a space where the truck will take it.
I got so sick of cutting out the boxes here, and when we started the business, and I knew we were gonna get boxes every day, I went and bought giant tin shears.
Yeah.
So I have these like giant scissors now that I can just cut through boxes in two things. Because I have to break, because we get so much often, I have to break it down and then twine it up and put it in this little 2x2 little package out there.
Yeah. If you're responsible at it, great. But everyone in the city, most of the time, just doesn't.
Yeah.
Everyone lives this such a fast paced life that the thought of stopping in the cities in general, it's like you just feel this energy of like this urgency, always go 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 go. That the thought of stopping and like bothering yourself with breaking down a box that your neighbor is not inconvenienced by it is like, that's so trite.
Nobody did it for me, so I'm not gonna do it for anybody else.
Yeah, of course.
It's one of those things.
And oftentimes, my wife and I will just be like, you know what? I have to put this in there, and I'm not going to be contributing to this. I'm not going to just take my big box that my TV came in or whatever and just leave it there. I'll cut that shit up into like, I mean, it's like, I'm like a brain surgeon when it comes to this thing. I will cut it up in the exact perfect way. I would take a bet. You can show me any trash receptacle, and I'm like, I can get that box in there. Guaranteed I can.
Yeah, I like those challenges too.
That's fun. Yeah. It's like a real life Tetris where you're like, oh, okay.
Exactly.
I hate breaking down boxes.
I love it.
Fucking drives me nuts.
I love it.
Well, that's why I have the big box cutter. It's like a switchblade.
Oh, the big dog? Yeah.
Yeah, so it comes out long and then you're like, and you, it's awesome.
I love it.
You rip through those boxes, man.
Yeah, it's a lot easier when you have a brand new razor. Like that's, I learned that early on. I'm like, oh, I'm just going to flip. It's like a switch razor.
But it can't be the normal box cutter. It's got to be the extendable one. You can get about 5 inches of blade.
See, I've never thought about that. That's awesome.
Huge difference. You prefer it over the shears.
I like the one where you can click and then break the blade off and keep going.
It scares me. I don't like, so it's one giant thin blade. I'd be afraid of it coming and pops off.
What it does is things about this big and go click 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 and the blade will come out like that and then,
yeah.
But it's all about the angle and the
sure.
So the more blade you have,
something,
the less
something,
energy.
Something that sharp, it terrifies me.
Yeah, it's very sharp.
Are your coffees here in the walking mug? Okay. Look at that.
There's no cream.
Yeah, maybe you should buy something for the house. Maybe that would help. Maybe you just don't come here and drink all the cream.
The last two creams were mine. I want you to know that.
Yeah, probably. I don't use it.
And
who the hell knows?
So what do you care?
So, yeah, there's got to be some reason. They've got to – I mean, it's just a mindset. I don't know, because like you're saying, it's always – it seems like it's older people out there doing it, right? And I do feel it comes down to being raised in a generation where, one, to contribute, but then every cent counts. Like, we're not that generation, right? Like –
yeah.
Oh, you can redeem this. No, it's too many steps. I don't want to do it.
Yeah, I think – I don't know the stats on this. I'm just talking out of my ass. But the majority of people I see, I don't think they're crazy, and I don't think that they're like any of these – like they're not homeless. Like they have homes.
Yeah.
I don't think they need to contribute. Is this just how they like to spend their time?
Probably not. All right, good,
cool. Go for it.
Probably not good team players and don't like bosses. You know,
well, no.
They have their own job on their own hours as long as they're willing to get up late at night.
I get that, but like it just sounds – I just don't get it from a – you are putting a lot of work in for very little return. That's
honestly
my only issue with it.
Honestly,
I want these
people
to get what they deserve.
Jesus Christ, Kevin.
I feel like it's a I feel like it's a third job. I feel like it's the job you do after the other job to just contribute. You know what
I
mean?
Just to chill out, to rest your mind.
I mean, that just doesn't seem worth it. It's like that $10, man. Fucking chill out, just sleep.
But what's really interesting is you saw that spike start happening after 208. Right? So it was after – that's what we noticed is that in 208 when the crash happened – the Wall Street crash.
Yeah.
Then we started noticing its behavior, and then there were competitors because we're in the hills of Berkeley, right? It's not like it's pedestrians going by, you know. So someone's actually got to be in a car and up there actually patrolling the neighborhood. And then we found out they're competing.
Oh wow!
So we're
this is our block.
Yeah. No, and Sherry's
all
like, "Well, I want to make sure the old lady gets it." So she's like waiting, hiding the garbage until she's estimating the old lady's time is going to show up, and then she's putting it out there. Then, you know, because the younger guy getting it, that's not going to be okay.
Oh, that's not good.
Right?
That's not cool.
Yeah,
that ain't cool, bro.
But I'm kind of, I don't know, having grown up sort of poor, and knowing people that didn't make it. You know, it's like, man, it's just, if you look at, so you grew up in San Francisco. Your parents are educated.
No, not really.
Professional.
I mean, barely.
Yeah.
I was scheming for a reason with the,
yeah,
with all the stuff, but it's just like, I don't know. Come on, guys.
But it's like, you know, some people's journey is just so far and long. Like I met a girl just recently. She was about to graduate art school. I believe it was her seventh year in a 4-year curriculum. And young girl from inner city Oakland, you know, and she was telling her story, right? And this is at a friend's house who's having like a yoga class there, right? And she's part of this class, still a young girl. What's her story? And you think about how, like, you talk to the kids that were Ivy League grads, they have so many tools going for them, right? And from day one up, usually, that they don't understand what they have by the time they get it out there and they need to start applying it. Like, they just take it for granted.
Right.
But here's the story of this girl. So she winds up in a condition where home is a complete disaster. She's got a kid that's a little brother that's about half her age. She's 14 and winds up on the street. So whatever, the household is such a disaster. She and the little brother are on the street. She's now, her purpose in life is keep the little brother okay. He doesn't make it. He gets killed. So now you got this young teenage girl on the streets alone with the sense of failure that her brother couldn't make it, right? No education, no role models, none of that. Mm-hmm. And going, well, in order to make him proud of what I've become, like his life would have been a waste if I don't do something with mine. And I'm kind of good at art, so I'll pursue that. And you listen to these stories of people who've really climbed out of it, like really climbed out of deep shit, like this girl, you know? And then she winds up like she's going to be graduating art school in San Francisco that she paid for herself for 7 years, that she started saving for when she was living on the street as a teenager, while, you know, other kids kind of didn't realize all the things that they had. But when we look at that,
band camp.
Yeah, like I used to be a real judgmental bastard about most things in life, you know? Just, I had all kinds of opinions about this. But the more I understood like people's tragedies, the more it became like harder to judge and feel clear about it, you know what you know what I mean? Like I'd usually catch myself in some like really embarrassing situation where you'd be like, oh god, I thought this person was an asshole, but they were really like had this handicap or something else. You're just like on the spot for being a real asshole, you know. But the stories, I mean, that's my thing. I'm a collector of stories. Like if we sit down, I want to hear your stories, man. I want to get it. I want to hear if you came from another country and you were locked in a storage container for 3 months on a boat. I want to hear about it. You know, I want to know what your experience was. And I look at that, and more time goes on, it's like the more the stories are just heart-wrenching in the modern world, you know, what people go through. So it gets harder to gauge it. But I look at it like the guy with the garbage can, he should get sentenced to a week at Burning Man. Right, like that's your sentence, dude. You got to stop being an asshole. You got to look at the world differently. Mm-hmm. And so the only way you're gonna get fixed is fucking Burning Man. Good luck, you know, and drop him off out there and see, because you know he'll find that the generosity of others is the only thing that's gonna keep him alive.
Right,
and that'll you know. Life-changing events, but look at that. Like, you know, real selfish. You know, real people are too close to their nut. Okay,
you seem like you'd be a fun judge.
Okay, what'd you do? Yeah,
Burning Man. Here's the Burning Man judge every time.
Only Burning Man, and the numbers inflated by 400%. I guess they already have problems with that. From what I heard from the last time Burning Man was, people couldn't get tickets to it now, huh?
Well, they started this whole, you know, lottery thing. It's like, what are you doing? You know, for 10 years, I never had a problem getting a ticket until they made sure scalpers couldn't get tickets, and then the people who really want them can't get them. And then you're like, what, are you turning this into a social game? It's like Zynga was designing the ticket policy, you know? You're like, what are you talking about? Keep coming back, and it'll be available for sale in 3 hours on one day. Like, what the fuck are you doing? You know, it's really upsetting, which is, you know, but you go out there and you die anyway. I mean, so harsh.
There's a fascinating documentary. They did a documentary about that, and like they have all, there's that original crew that plans it every year.
Yeah.
And they talk about how it's sad because it's one of those things that's supposed to be this really free and open experience. And because it's gotten so big, they've had to put regulations and restrictions and laws on it.
Yeah.
Because and they'll even say that, like, it's disappointing. This goes a little bit against what this thing is for. But if we don't do this, if we don't charge prices, ticket prices, we can't have ambulances. We can't have ER people. We can't have people.
And that's all fine. Sure. But lose the social game of lottery bullshit that they injected in, which is like, who designed? I swear, it's like the worst social gaming company they hired to figure out how to sell the tickets. And now you're talking about an event like Burning Man, right? We're not talking Coachella, where you go down there and you know you're going to go to a concert for a couple days and stay in your little tent on grass. Right? No, we're talking about you go out there and you die. There's if nothing. You're not prepared, right? Ants don't even live there. They're like, fuck this. We moved out a long time ago.
Right? We moved to Seattle a long time ago.
It's literally that bad. You know, I've seen 121 degree days out there. Right? Jesus like shit Christ. Is crazy out there at times. And so you need, if you're going to do it right, you need to plan a whole year in advance. Except the way that they do is they go, well, you know, as you missed the February lotto for this, but you didn't get picked. But, you know, coming up again in May, and you're like, the event's in August.
Yeah, I got a plan for this thing. It's like summoning K2.
Maybe
you're
I'll
like,
be
I
able to go,
know,
maybe I won't. So
this.
I just stopped going, you know. And, I think a number of people do that, but a lot of more people are showing up. But the other thing that was interesting is that when I started going there, I remember the first year I went, it was great people. There was one bar that I remember where people were serving alcohol. Everyone else is high on something else, right? There's one bar. Now it's all bars, which means a lot more alcohol, a lot more people. And I can guarantee you this, no one ever got smarter on alcohol, right?
Yeah. Ever. I'll tell you what they did get is dehydrated,
yeah.
which is, which is not good. And because they probably didn't bring water either. Mm-hmm. No, it's a fascinating. If you get a chance, there's a great documentary on Netflix about it. And not, it's not a great
overall
documentary.
Burning Man, or just this like the tickification.
It's the beginning of Burning Man, all the way up until I think Burning Man 2012 when they.
How long's Burning Man been going?
94 or something. Okay. Was the first something one like on that. The beach.
Yeah. They did the beach out in
93.
That beach, right?
Yeah, North San Francisco. Out.
I can't remember where we're at.
Seaside.
Seaside. It's fascinating because they start with a complete and total blank canvas, and their methodology behind it is, it's like they don't leave anything behind.
Right.
So like they have groups of at the very end of the event, they have groups of volunteers that will walk like you're looking for someone in the forest.
Yeah.
And they will make sure there's no nails, no cigarette screws, butts. Cigarette butts, anything left behind.
No trace.
They go down and pick it up. It's really fascinating. But then the other fascinating thing is they show how they have to store all the shit. Because like half of the infrastructure, they have to have infrastructure because it's so big. You have to have like booths and places for people to go if they're not feeling well, things like that. It's all stored off-site, like miles away. And so they start loading in that show like a month in advance or something. Yeah. It's crazy, man. Yeah, it's crazy. It's an industry, but it's still, I think, from what I've heard, a lot of people say it's still worth going to. It's still worth experiencing.
You don't die without going to Burning Man. Meaning, like, don't hit your grave without seeing that first. Like, no matter what.
It sounds absolutely horrible.
It's absolutely insane.
How many years did you go?
About 12.
Okay.
You know, it's but the first year it totally changed my life.
Really?
That's what everybody says.
It renewed my faith in humanity. It's like if it were a business plan, right? It says here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna drag 50,000 people out into the harshest one of the top 10 harshest environments on planet Earth. Right? Like I said, ants don't live there. Insects are like fuck this place. Right? Insects. Think about that, right? So
these are the things that absolutely don't live through the apocalypse.
Yeah, exactly.
And they won't go to Burning
Roaches?
Man.
No, they don't go to Burning Man.
They're
like, what are you, crazy?
Thank you for doing the Beetlejuice.
Yeah, but when you got there, I mean, the first year I went was with Josh Gabriel, the DJ I grew up with, bass, Gabriel in Dresden, okay. You know, stuff like that. Tony Fadell, who just did Nest.
Oh,
yeah, you know, when you invent the iPod and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And out there with characters like that, but we're like dying underneath, you know, horrible conditions. They brought me out. I had never been out there before. I had heard certain types of music. I'm like, where is that music? I've never heard that before. And they're like, you got to go to Burning Man. It's so intense that you get a different sound. You get different things happening because the environment is just so harsh. You're all in it together, right? Mm-hmm. And then what you're looking at, like, you know, I mean, the trust funders, the trustafarians, you know, they're coming in from all over the world, right? Japan, China, wherever the people are coming there, because there is no party like it on Earth, mm-hmm. right? So if you can imagine an endless sprawl where you have 117 or 114 miles of streets, which is actually the layout plan. If you were to walk the whole distance, it's like 112 miles if you're covering every street. And it's so enormous and so insane and so off the hook and yet so safe. You know, like I've never seen a fight. I mean, there's Thunderdome, the club, the East Bay Rats, the Fight Club.
They have as the documentary Thunderdome out there. Thunderdome.
And the guys, you know, sometimes you'll see people ultimate fighting, and you're like, it's fucking Burning Man. You're ultimate. You're bashing each other's faces in. But hey, you know, that's
what
their
they
want
to do.
And
let's go, Tim.
What the fuck?
Yeah.
This is a real thing. This by is the way, that people the, do. Let's the, go yeah. get super stoned and fight each other.
At the end of it. Oh my god. At the end of it, they have the Burning Man. They have the burn.
They burn him in.
Which where they build this gigantic wooden statue.
Oh, okay.
And
I was about to walk the fuck out. I was like, no.
They get everyone in a safe distance away, and they light this thing on fire, and it's this giant, amazing thing that everyone's experiencing.
So this is like industrial accidents at the entertainment level, meaning this is like industrial accidents for entertainment, right? It's unbelievable. And we were out there one time, and they did. So we didn't know what was going on, but they said, it's so big and so many things going on, you can't see everything. Mm-hmm. It's impossible.
Because there's like districts and stuff, right?
It's,
like I've
it
heard.
Is a million things happening at once. Yeah, so the idea that you're going like, to schedule
something.
Well, you said
116 miles?
112 or 114.
Something like that, yeah.
Miles of streets laid out. Look at the satellite.
It's a neighborhood. I mean,
they build up a neighborhood out of nothing.
It's a city, man. Yeah. It's a city, you know? And
look, Google a picture of it from the satellite. It looks like a giant fucking crop circle.
It's a big pagan symbol.
It's nuts, man.
Fucking shit.
Yeah. So then when they burn a man and stuff like that, you know, it's industrial scale. I mean, 200-foot flames are, you know, it's real. It's very real. Mm-hmm. One time we were out there and we didn't know it was happening, but they were scheduling. They were going to do the biggest explosion ever at Burning Man.
Just hold on. Let's rewind. Because
someone had to.
The biggest explosion ever. Just ever.
At Burning Man.
Wait, the biggest explosion at Burning Man?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Not ever.
Not ever.
Ever would be like a volcano.
That'd be like planet blows up.
Okay. Not good. We're going to do it, man. Okay. The biggest explosion ever.
No sequels. So, yeah. So we're standing there, you know, at a sound camp, which is actually run by Jeff, who founded Monster.com.
Okay.
And he's got people like Crystal Method out there playing on 100,000 sound watt, fucking insane sound camp. And we're standing there, like, setting some stuff up, and it's, you know, not dark out yet. And all of a sudden, we see a flash off in the distance. Now, it's miles, right? You can go out miles on perfectly flat. That's where they sent land speed records. We see this flash, and I think either a plane crashed or a tanker blew up, like a full-size tractor trailer tanker blew up. That's how big it was. And you see this, boom, this flash, and then this huge mushroom cloud of flame rising like a nuclear bomb. Oh, over there, you know, like hundreds of feet in the air, like, and we're like, holy shit. And you watch, and you're looking at the ground, and then there's this wave, the shock wave is like coughing
it's
up.
It's like the
beginning
of Terminator 2.
And you're like, and
then Lauren's on a chain link.
Wow, man.
Holy shit, this sounds. Like
Tim, I feel like you'd like.
See, you're gonna go, man.
No, I'm not. This is scary.
And everyone there is in a great mental state to see a nuclear explosion and not panic.
Yeah. Oh my god, Nick, can you imagine this? Me and you go to freaking Burning Man.
Often talked about this. Now
do a show from Burning Man.
I thought you're not allowed to bring cameras or phones or.
Well, you're not supposed to, but everyone does. So,
okay.
You know, yeah.
So sorry, Kevin. I believe in rules.
Here's my only concern with it right now is that if I went, I'd have to go without my wife. Which is not a concern at all.
If you were to go, you'd have to get divorced.
I'd probably have to get divorced first. But if she were to go with me, the problem now is that the rich go. And when the rich go, they bring their RVs. And last year, from what I understand, one of my friends was telling me that the RVs, they park their RVs this close away from each other so no one can squeeze by, and they make their own encircled like village where it's like
it's the billionaire's
air conditioned, all the stuff, like everything's catered, so you bring your own chef and stuff like that. My wife would want to stay there, and
yeah,
I can't
see,
afford
I can get
it.
Down with that.
And I think it's kind of a
I think
the antithesis
it's
of what
it's 20 grand.
Is it 20 grand?
That spot. Yeah, that's sort of the Zuckerberg.
Dude, just
and those
be there. So then you got
to
bring your own
to,
shit.
To be able to camp there with
yeah.
them. Yeah.
But then you got to bring your own RV and all your own food and stuff. So that's probably another 10 grand.
Well,
top
I think they'll
that.
Take care of the food and
oh,
stuff.
Oh, will
like
they do
that.
It?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
And then there was an article, I think Wired did it.
Kevin,
it
you're fired. On, I need that money. Sorry.
It was on the people that were working for them out there. And they were like, fuck this. I'll never do it again.
Yeah.
Servicing a bunch of billionaires at Burning Man. Fuck this.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah
it's
like
terrible.
It's,
what's the point? Yeah. After watching the documentary, I was like, I kind of want to go to this.
You got to go once. You got
to
go once.
But you don't have to go for the whole time, by the way. They do shuttles now.
I'm sure I'll be blown away.
They do shuttles now that they didn't used to before. You had to just kind of get yourself, but you can get shuttled in and out of it on a day thing if you want. Like if you're like, I don't want to do this. I'm tired. Sorry, I can't do this. You can get out fast.
But that doesn't sound like you would get the real experience. That's
getting touristy. I think the only way you could actually swing that, because you can't predict traffic, right? You could be stuck in 8 hours on one road and not go anywhere. It's happened to me a couple times. But the sure way in and out is you fly in and out. You know, because they got an airstrip
there.
There's a fucking airport there?
Basically, yeah.
They just
but I did
an
see a plane crash there and it blew up, you know, because it's high altitude, right? It's
I
high
should
altitude.
Definitely, I should try it at least once. This sounds great. Nothing can go wrong. There's explosions that you actually feel the wave from. Planes crash. The biggest explosion of all fucking time. This sounds
and
great.
And they
great
ended,
sorry,
got, yeah. They ended all by lighting a statue that they try to get bigger and bigger every year on fire.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm down with that. Yeah. I like it as an idea. I also like looking
and
at all the Facebook pictures.
Everyone is
later.
Having sex with each other.
Yeah, I know.
And they're
that's
all
what the
stinky.
Pictures are good for.
Yeah, no, they don't stink because it's talc. It's not sand. It's talc. So everyone gets covered in this like light powder. And for some reason, you don't smell everyone. Like you
really?
Do at a concert.
Yeah.
So you don't smell BO everywhere, which
really?
Is amazing. It's not just because you smell so bad.
It's not on the salt flats, though, right?
No, it's not salt. It's talc.
Talc.
So it's literally like talc. This is where they get talc powder.
I've never seen Tim so upset at a story.
I just like.
He's so uncomfortable. The pure one can't handle it.
Yeah.
But let me, I'll give you a quick Burning Man story.
Sure. Please.
So we're walking around. I got a buddy of mine. He's an actor in LA. He's in Spielberg's new series that's coming up with the ETs and stuff. And really good guy. We went to school together. He's like, okay, I'll go. You know, we go out there. And he's just completely blown away. He's like, I need to go meditate. You know, dude's like 6'5". He's like, I need to go meditate, man. It's just like way overwhelming. So anyway, very shortly, we're walking around. We find, and it's only about like 114 degrees out.
Only.
And we find there's a cold sake bar. right? Like cold sake, and it's all being served by like these gorgeous girls that are all naked. So we're like, we are so going for sake right now. Right?
And we go, you're starting to win me over.
And we're sitting there at the sake bar, right? And there's this little Japanese kid, and maybe he's like 17 or 18 or 20 something, you know, small kid, and he's red as a lobster. I mean, he's just absolutely unprepared. We're like, dude, man, what happened to you? You know, he's like, and he's speaking Brooklyn English, and he's like, I just knew, you know, Burning Man, so I thought it was like a concert, you know? So I come out here, I get here, I'm like, it's not like a concert. He goes, but these people are great, man. And he's got all this shit, and he's like, people gave me this, and people gave me this, and they gave me the sunscreen, and they gave me this, and he goes, I got nothing, but I got a Sharpie, and I'll write my name on you. You know, and we were like, hey, you know what? You need some of these too, and you need some of that, and we give him some stuff. And he's like, I can write my name in kanji on your arm, right? I'll write your name in kanji here, right? Mm-hmm. Now, at this one little bar where people are just drinking cold sake in the middle of the day, he does that. And another guy's here. He's like, well, I speak Farsi, man. You want me to put your name in Farsi, right? And so we had, by the time everyone at this bar in the next like hour had their name written in about 9 different languages and different alphabets, you know, mm-hmm. in Chinese, in... It was an amazing thing. In Arabic, you know, it was like wow, you know, and that just happens. Like those things, you had all these people from all over the world. They all look like they're homeless at this moment.
Yeah.
Know? And then you find out these are extraordinary minds. Like you'll never know who you're actually bumping into. And there's some incredible things that happen out there. It's kind of magical. You know? And part of it is the mutual suffering.
Mm-hmm.
And make no mistake, and it is suffering because it's so brutal. But when it gets into, this is why all the best DJs in the world will go out there and love playing it. Because there's nothing like it when mm-hmm. everyone's suffering together, and then you let loose.
It's like it is powerful.
Not like going to a concert.
Yeah.
It makes concerts look like romper room, man. Uh-huh. It's just a joke, you know. It's over the top.
So Tim, there you go. We'll go, and you'll sell your. You can sign.
As you were saying that, I was like, I'm okay. Naked women in. I get to write my name on people's arms. I'm double in.
Or boobs in on the naked women.
Right.
You jumped in.
And it looks like the apocalypse. It looks like it actually looks less like everyone's homeless and more like it does look like the Road Warrior. When you look at pictures of it, you're like, this is like a nice version of Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome.
So okay, and what's up with the names? Like you get different names.
Well, that's like
what's your name?
I don't do the apply name thing. You know, I feel like that was for the people who started a long time ago and I started later, so I didn't feel quite like I was hip enough to. Mm. But I think a lot of it is they don't want to
what you do
Man
there. You don't want following you home, right?
Yeah, and it's certainly if people are gonna let it down, it's gonna happen there more than
I
want to
be called the Oak.
The Oak,
something cool, or the Redwood, the Great Redwood. You know what I mean, Tim? Because usually it's like Moonbeam or Stardust or something cool like that. I just straight up want to be like, I need it to be a euphemism for my penis. No?
Yeah, I like it. I mean, I'm totally into it.
We'll call yours
The Giving Tree.
The Giving Tree?
The Hedge.
I like all this. This is really good.
All right, so we're going to Burning Man this year.
No, I mean, no.
Dude. You guys need to do a podcast from Burning Man.
If you go to Burning Man, we'll go. We'll
oh, go don't fucking no. don't do sign us up for that shit. Don't sign us up for that shit. Jesus,
that's so
Christ.
Scary.
We and could that- bring all. We just set this up because people do that shit. Like they have these art directors and set designers, these guys that it's their job normally to do this stuff. They'll spend 2 months with the crew and make like one of the guys in the documentary made Wall Street. He made like 3 different buildings on Wall Street and then they burned him down. It was fucking nuts.
Symbolism.
Yeah, they put a lot of energy in things they're going to burn.
My God.
Yeah, that's crazy.
See,
man.
Here's the thing.
And girls.
Yeah.
Gorgeous.
Good.
That's lots of.
And
beautiful.
They're just not uninhibited. They're uninhibited. That's why I want to bring, my wife, so that I don't get into any sort of trouble. I'm lying to you right now. I'm 100% lying to myself. Tim just gave me the, you're trying to save yourself.
Yeah. No, this is, my friends are pretty like-minded to me, so I think the majority of my friends are like, fuck that. This does not sound like something I'd ever want to do. But then the few people I do know that go, I'm like, okay, you would go. You would be one of those people that go. But then you hear their stories, and you're like, they're all like this, where they're just these crazy shit. They're like, dude, it changed my fucking life. And it's just, it made me see things differently. I'm just like, I don't know if I need to see things that way. Like, you're a changed person, man.
Like, yeah, I like the way I see things, man. I'm happy. I don't want to change. No, I mean, I think it's one of those situations where, it's going to be what you need it to be. And I think a lot of people go out there and they're so stressed out and they just need that freeing experience of like, I can do anything right now. Like the only thing that is holding me back from anything is myself. So let's get rid of that with something and let's go be free for at least a few days.
It's a pretty interesting concept, man. They have fireworks. It's all good.
I mean, it's going to cost you as much to go to Disneyland for a day as it will with Burning Man for 3 days. So
true.
Yeah, but think about it. At Disneyland, what's the chance of one of those fireworks hitting you?
I like we said it like it's a selling factor. It's like,
think about it. Oh, you ever watch Saudi drift racing?
Oh God!
That's what we could do. Yeah. We could start Tokyo Drift.
I like that.
Yeah, we could start Fast and Furious flat racing,
and
that's
then awesome. Burn it down.
Yeah,
good
burn
lord,
that, burn that rice rocket down. That'd be amazing.
So Nick, Greg, yeah. I have a question for you.
Yeah,
is Burning Man a topic?
I thought it might be there.
I think it's
it
going to
be seemed like it already
I think
was.
We should do that.
That was just so...
Because I can't wait for the headline and thumbnail on that.
Look at how mad Kevin is because now he's got to go back and listen.
Figure
there's
it
a
out,
point
Kevin.
In that conversation where we deviate pretty hard
from recycling.
From recycling. So if you hear us talking about naked people at a sake bar, that's not the recycling portion of the topic.
Yeah, it was right what I asked. Because I'm fascinated by people's like that have gone to Burning Man. Because yeah. to me, there's something.
Everybody who comes back says this, that it changed their life and you got to go.
You can't,
point.
You know. It's impossible. There's certain things that are impossible to communicate, like a DMT trip. Right. You heard Joe
wait,
Rogan.
What's it?
DMT?
Yeah. Oh, right. Okay.
Dimethyltryptamine. You can't communicate it. You know, you
got to do it.
You're trying it or you're not, but you can read books. You can study it for 20 years and you can't comprehend the experience. Burning Man's like that. You can read the books. You can look at the footage. But no matter what, no matter how you're hearing about it, you're hearing about it through a small lens.
Right.
Like this. But the experience is like this. So the scale is incomprehensible. And that's what's so freaky. I mean, imagine pulling up to like the circus of the insane at night. And for miles, all you see is like insane circus. The lights, the neon, the fires, the this, the people in fucking insane clothes. 40-foot snails driving by. You know, big ducks that are rock concerts driving by that cost $1 million to build the art.
See, this
concert.
Is so weird because it's so many cool things.
It's like a
it's like you sold me. You're scaring me. You sold me. You're really scaring me.
It's like living in Tim Burton's brain.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Right. Right.
Here's my question. I can't remember if this was a certain section of it or from a friend's story he was telling me. Is there no money at Burning Man or is there just a section?
It's not supposed to be money.
Okay.
You know, the only thing you can buy at Burning Man is coffee and ice, to the best of my knowledge.
Okay. Okay.
And then that's sold by by the organization. And gotcha. Beyond that, it's supposed to be barter.
Gotcha.
That's the idea.
Gotcha. So you bring things to trade kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. That's gotcha. The idea. But I think with time, you get like when I first started to go, there was more people really engaging that. And as time goes on, it seems like there's more looky-loos
okay.
rather than participators.
Sure, sure, sure.
In the beginning, when they first started going out there, it was like you couldn't go unless you participated. You know, you were doing some type of artistic something.
Yeah, they have the rules, right? Aren't there like 5 rules, the original rules of like one – is or like rule number 5 is everyone has to participate, like everyone yeah. has to be exchanged the barters. I can't remember what yeah. 1 through 5 is, but so, some of them are like everything has to be sustainable. You have to whatever you bring in, you have to bring out.
Leave no trace
is one of them. Yeah, so it's I mean it's pretty fascinating. What the core tenets of it are really really cool.
Yeah.
It's basically like what would happen if you just shut down civilization. We all had to just be equal and figure it out. And it's kind of an interesting concept. And that's why whenever anyone says they've been to it, I'm always fascinated because it takes balls to put yourself in that environment for even an hour or let alone 3
days. It's rough. You need a vacation when you get back.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, it's rough.
Like I watch a lot of documentaries about climbing K2 and I'm like, that seems hard too. But since I'm part of the climbing community, we'll do it one day. Because it is it's one of the highest places. Yeah. Yeah, ice picks.
Wow.
Yes, Kevin. But I mean, I'm just fascinated by something that takes that amount of energy to plan
yeah.
and then go out and execute, because there is a part of all of us that like we just don't we're not challenged like that on a day-to-day basis, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know, and I'm speaking from what we've done in the last few months is like you don't know what you're capable of unless you challenge yourself on that scale.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying like what we did is
this is like our K2.
It's probably harder.
No, yeah,
joking.
I think so.
But
do they ever run out of coffee pods on K2?
I tell you what they don't have. That, I mean, their Walgreens is way closer than ours.
There's no sake booth on the way up.
They freeze their nipples off, unfortunately. Yeah, so I'm fascinated by it. One day, we'll have to think about it, but it's not going to be
today. One day, we'll think about it.
You know, it's just really kind of an ultimate counterculture expression, really. It's an arts festival, and that's really what mm-hmm. it is. You know, and people should see it for that experience, and then they're going to come back different. I mean, I've walked down and I've been like, is this guy all right?
Yeah, yeah.
Someone just sitting there like this, you know, and you go, hey, dude, you okay?
How much stuff do you bring with you when you go to this thing?
Man, I got the 22-foot diameter tent dome.
Okay, you know. So you come and like
yeah, I'm set up.
You got all.
Do you call it Thunderdome 2? No, is that where it all goes down?
No, I saw it from Sid Griss. He's a big DJ. He runs a camp out there called Opulent Temple, and he just had this tent. I was like, oh my god, that makes life so much easier. And then you got to sun shield it. You know, so there's a whole dialing in to learn. First year, just take an RV.
Yeah,
you know, and then you got the bathroom, you got the air conditioner, and all that. But
see, now I have this vision of you with your own little dome, and you're like a Moulin Rouge esque like ringleader.
I was gonna say the same thing, where he's like basically like every hour, like at a certain hour during the day, there's 1 hour where the master like comes out of his tent, and Lauren's just like carried. It's like that scene from 300 where the Persian like emperor is being carried by the guys on his gigantic throne with a thing that's going over his ear.
Oh man, I wish
that'd be dope. Next year we'll make it happen for you.
We'll be your entourage. We'll make sure that happens.
I have seen one where there was about 8 muscle-bound guys carrying these gorgeous women on a pedestal like that. That's, you know, hot. it was like a Queen of Sheba theme or something. They're just walking through and whips
right next to the giant snail,
and these guys right next to the giant snail, you know, bodybuilding dudes.
That's awesome. Hilarious. That is awesome. See, I would want to see that one. I mean, that's my problem, is I'd want to see it and then immediately go back to my hotel where it's air conditioned, take a shower and just decompress for a while. Yeah. But like, that's the whole
point. It
doesn't
go that way. No, it's way worse than that.
Let's go and like dress as Star Trek people and act like we landed there.
You'll see some. It'll be there. Yeah, sure. Yeah, someone will be driving around in a Starship Enterprise or something. It'll be there. You bet. Their art cars is huge. You know.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's crazy. It's totally intimidating though. Just hearing the stories, I'm like, I don't think I can hack it. I don't know if I can do it. I don't think I can do it.
Entire city of
Bader. I burn easy.
Oh, you be dead, bro.
I drink a lot, like the booze. So if I saw that, then I'm going to dehydrate it already.
Oh, you got to just pace it out. We'll have to get you on some sort of illicit substance instead of booze. You'll have to start smoking weed.
Okay. Wait a minute,
you live here and you don't?
No.
Wow.
Yeah.
Greg's not really like, he doesn't have a, he likes to drink, that's it.
Yeah. Wow. I like wings. I got my vices, comic books and stuff.
Video games.
Yeah. Video games, yeah. All right, I'm going to finish with my topic.
Okay.
If you don't mind.
No, not at all.
Colin Moriarty's not here. Mm-mm. So somebody has to bring.
Oh, okay.
The intellectual.
There you go. The glasses.
The intellectual glasses.
Pulling
look.
A call in there.
And this hurts my eyes. I don't know why he does this. And then you look over here. So we're going to talk, ladies and gentlemen, about a place near and dear to my heart. It's called Shakespeare's Pizza. Mm-hmm. It's in Columbia, Missouri. Many people know this. It opened in 1973, and it's been in the news lately. Now, the national news, perhaps not, but the Columbia news. But stick with me, all right? April 1st, no fooling, they post this article. Downtown Shakespeare's Pizza location slated for demolition. Now, what I will tell you, outsiders, and this is going to get to a broader topic, stick with me, is that Shakespeare's is like the Columbia, Missouri restaurant. This is, like I said, 1973, this place opened, right at the edge of campus, right in front of the journalism school. I can't tell you the number of pizza and slices I've eaten in there, you know what I mean, whether it be I order and carry it out or what there. And that's not me. That's everybody who went to Mizzou has that. I forgot I was doing this. I usually drink out of a Shakespeare's cup or a CJ's cup. I'm using CJ's
man,
cup.
Tighten the screws is all I'm saying.
Shut up, Nick. You don't know what the hell you're talking about. You're a piece of shit. Anyways.
It went here and it just went down.
That's not going to help the theories that I hate you.
That was the best.
But no, that, I mean, like, legitimately, if you see me with the clear cup and the green writing, it's a Shakespeare's cup. Anyone who's ever been to Shakespeare's has one of those cups. People will identify them, call them out in the comments if they just run into us. Like, it's a thing, right? This is a Columbia landmark. Mm-hmm. So they announced that it's getting demolished, right? I'll read you some of the story here. For decades, it has stood as a small but iconic building at the corner of 9th and Elm Streets, and now developers are gearing up to tear it down. By the way, this is Alicia over at the Columbia Daily Tribune. Shakespeare's downtown location at 225 South 9th Street will move around the corner in late May in preparation for the building's demolition to make way for a multi-story structure with Shakespeare's as a ground floor tenant. So, not a clickbaity headline, but a scary headline when you read that, right? Mm-hmm. But what's happening is Shakespeare's, it's 1973, the building's being demolished. Mm-hmm. Shakespeare's, the company, will go to a building around the side while they build a multi-structured giant for Columbia, Missouri, high-rise standards, right, for things there. And so, as the article will go on, right, Shakespeare's will be the ground floor tenant, and it'll basically, in theory, it's going to look like the old Shakespeare's building with the apartments on top of it. The manager of Shakespeare's, Kurt, of course, known as the Big Cheese there, he says, quote, "We've taken 360 digital photos of the place. Basically, we're doing everything we can possibly do to just shy of numbering the bricks and taking it apart piece by piece." So the plan is to respect the tradition here, mm-hmm. respect the probably the facade, make it look the same outside, make it look the same on the inside, but build all this stuff out, right? Uh-huh. I flip out about this. I immediately take to Twitter, and I say something like, this is the worst news I've ever heard, and I had a doctor break the news that I have cancer to me. You know what I mean? Like, this is like...
Way to make light of cancer, Greg.
Hey, I'm allowed... I did,
Across America.
I had cancer. I can say what I want about
That's
it.
That's fair enough.
And this is a bigger news story than when I had cancer. This affects more people. And so, this happens. I make that tweet. It gets put in the Kansas City Star in their roundup of basically people overreacting about Shakespeare's the building being demolished. And kids on the Twitter, our fans, our best friends here, are tweeting me, and they're like, I don't really get it. Like, the people aren't losing their jobs. No one's going to lose a job in this. They're moving it around. They're going to rebuild it. And I had to keep saying, well, it's not that they're rebuilding it or not. It's that they're just demolishing that building. I'll never have the memory of eating, you know, pizza there with Kyle Kappas ever, like, way too often during lunches and this, that, and the other, and all these stupid things. Like,
Kyle Kappas, that son of a bitch.
All the memories I have about it, you know what I mean? Like, that's not my Shakespeare's. Because since I went to school there, Shakespeare's opened two more locations in Columbia, right? That you go into, and again, they're like the facsimile of Shakespeare's downtown. Like, they're newer, they're nicer, they try to make them look like it, but it's still, like, not my Shakespeare's.
I don't like when they feel like a TGI Fridays where you're like, it's exactly the same.
Yeah.
On purpose. You're like, whoa, there's like the same pictures and shit. That's weird. Tokyo. Yeah. I don't like that. Yeah. You're like, what the fuck? It's the same boat.
Greg, this is a little too soon for me. Just in general.
Yeah. Oh, because your pizza place.
I had a recent loss in the family.
Right.
Where my favorite pizza place and yours literally.
What?
Burned down?
What?
Just fucking with you. Go.
Just go. Keep going.
Sbarro's is gone too now. I don't like Sbarro's though. Signora's literally blew up. When the car right into the gas main.
Yeah,
really?
But what a way to go. What a way to go.
Out in San Bruno.
No shit.
Right by San Bruno.
You can still drive. We drove past it yesterday.
And it's just fucking exploded.
Was there people in there?
No, everyone's fine.
Jesus.
A fun aside to that story is the fact that Alexa Ray, you know, Mitch's girlfriend, of course, GameSpot, friend of the show and kind of funny, she tweeted the other day a conversation between her and Mitch on the phone where she was like, I'm sick, I'm going to order a pizza. And then it was like, oh, yeah, I forgot my pizza place burned down. And I was like, oh, I know where you ordered your pizza.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it just burned out. It exploded.
Yeah, I think that's what she said.
But yesterday I went to get Signora's for the first time since then at their other location, and it's not the same.
Sure.
And it just
Well, that's the thing about Shakespeare's is like this could be urban legend, but I'm pretty sure it's not, that they never turn off their ovens. They just let them go at all times because they want it to be that hot, cuz like it's down to a science. Shakespeare's pizza tastes a certain way, and what they had said is like when they opened the new locations, it took something like 9 months to a year to make the pizzas taste the same coming out of that oven, like to get that oven broken and do all this different
stuff. Is it one of the traditional ovens that like is a conveyor belt, or is it like a wood
burner? No. It's one you open it and you put the
the big dog like cast iron ovens.
Like giant ones. I think it was just
There are those people that will think about like cooks will tell you like their pans have that sort of flavor to them, similar to the ovens where like so much of the molecules have been burnt off into there that it bakes like a certain flavor profile into all the crust and things like that. Now, you're still gonna get that though. You still got the oven.
That's neither here nor there. Yes. Again, I don't think them moving the pizzas will taste different. It's just they're demolishing my Shakespeare. I'm not even to the thrust of my topic yet.
Okay.
This is just setting up what happens. This is the April 1st article. Oh my God, they're demolishing Shakespeare's. I tweet out, the Mizzou Nation tweets out their anger about this, right? In the basic message is, I hope they change their mind. I hope they see everyone's upset about this, that the dumpy building that I'm sure could be a million times better if they did it means something to us nostalgia-wise in terms of what Columbia and what Mizzou is and da-da-da-da. I hope the people who own the building see this. They change their mind. Here's where we go. Here's where things get interesting. This is, again, from the Columbia Daily Tribune. This one from Caitlin. This is 6 days later, April 7th. Proposed demolition moratorium may halt Shakespeare's downtown project. Prompted by public outcry over the planned demolition of Shakespeare's Pizza downtown, the Columbia City Council added a bill to its agenda Monday night to put a six-month moratorium on demolition of downtown buildings in historic areas. The proposal, added to the agenda by a 4-2 vote, would delay processing demolition permit applications for downtown structures in areas included in the National Register of Historic Places, located at 9th and Elm Streets. Shakespeare's downtown location is included in that area and would be protected from demolition. This pisses me the fuck off.
Why? Isn't that what you wanted?
No, I don't want that. Like, first off, they demolish Shakespeare's no matter, and they build a new one. It'll be fine. I know that. It won't be my Shakespeare's. No big deal. I wanted the owner of the building, the private owner of the building. Because, again, Shakespeare's doesn't own the building. Shakespeare's rents it from someone.
Yeah, they rent
right?
it from someone.
Exactly. I wanted the owner of Shakespeare's to realize what he had and change his mind. I do not, under any circumstance, want the Columbia City Council to step in and say, all right, private business. No. You don't get to do that with your building. And so this is what I'm what I want to talk about. I want to talk about how much control do you think city government should have on a private business?
The problem is this, though. Do you know that it's a privately owned building, or is it owned by a property management company that is not a person? Did the guy sell it a long time ago? You see what I'm saying? Because that would make a difference. If he did, then
I want to give you the right information.
The city's only recourse would be to say we have to make this a statute. Now, otherwise, they're just going to do whatever they want because they have the state's not allowed really to come in unless it's deemed a historic.
When
property.
Was the building built?
That's a good question.
And it's brick.
How much
right?
pizza was sold?
If
lots
it's brick,
high ceilings.
It is bricks. No, it's low ceilings.
Okay, tear it down.
Yeah, I mean, but that's a legitimate concern.
If it was high ceilings, man, don't touch that shit, you know?
That's a legitimate concern, though, because a lot of those old brick buildings, like, there's a famous one down in L.A. It's an Italian restaurant that I can't remember, but they have to come in and do a lot of retrofitting to get those to be fire code. Otherwise, the building in
the building's fire code. It's been open since 1970.
Earthquake code, which in Colombia you don't necessarily need to worry about. But, yeah, in L.A., like, go into any brick building that's legitimately, like, freestanding brick building. And there's cross members put everywhere, steel things,
well, here
like
too.
Big things. Yeah, here. Here too. That's a good point. But yeah, brick not the best way to build a building. Just FYI. Like,
yeah.
Back in the day, they didn't plan those too properly.
I lost my place in the '94 quake.
Did you?
Well, it was in my apartment. Yeah, I had a rent control apartment. That's what's.
That's the worst.
When I had a 3-bedroom rent control apartment that I was paying nothing for in Studio City, it was like nothing was going to get me out of there, you know. But the quake did.
Shit,
I took that building out.
Yeah, I'm one of those schmucks that has earthquake insurance.
Yeah, well, I did too.
Yeah.
And well, did I it had cover? Apartment insurance, but I couldn't believe it. I actually got a check from FEMA.
Really?
Yeah, FEMA was like, oh, you're a victim. Okay, here.
I was like,
no way.
Yeah,
wow.
I thought
FEMA was like, you know,
some real
the dark
shit.
Side.
I guess
yeah.
that is real
here
shit.
Here we go. No, yeah, it was real.
I got earthquake insurance, and the guy was like, I have to sell you, like, I want to sell you a fire insurance policy as well. And I was like, I mean, when it comes to those things, I get really scared, so I buy all of them and end up spending way too much money on insurance. But they said that because a lot of people's houses don't get destroyed by the earthquakes, what happens is a fire starts, and the fire will burn your house down. Mm-hmm. And you're like, and then the earthquake insurance won't cover it because they're like, no, technically it's fire damage.
Right.
And you're like, well, that's shit.
That's some bullshit.
Or the sprinklers go off, and then it's water damage. And you're like, but come on, we're meant to, but the insurance companies are shitheads. Don't deal with them if you don't have to. I don't know, Greg. That's interesting. I mean, you basically just cost someone a lot of money because of that tweet.
I didn't. It was already there, and they should have known it was coming, obviously. They should have
It seems like it was your fault.
Yeah, well, I don't care. I'll take it. But that's the thing is I did contribute to it, obviously. They all saw my tweet and understood they had to change things. But it, like, I don't want them changing it this way. You know what I mean?
Someone related this to cancer.
So what was your next tweet?
Ah, here it is. See, yeah, it's owned by the Odell brothers and the Raider family, which I assume means it's, you know, just that they broke into marriage. That's how it worked.
Right.
So it's privately held by a family.
Okay.
So that's the thing. And
yeah,
now,
so they were probably like, hey, we want to get rid of this building.
No, wait a minute. That's got high ceilings.
Well, I mean, it's not like vaulted ceilings.
No, but they're, you know, 10 plus feet. That's real. It's not like New England old, you know, 7-foot
ceilings. There
you go.
That's what I mean. That's a better
pretty
view.
High ceilings, Greg. I mean, your idea of high ceilings.
I guess we all have. I mean, it's one floor. I didn't know.
They got the tin roof. The old style.
That's a really pretty building.
I know, right? That's
unfortunate.
And it's going to be gone.
See, now I'm all for the historic, the brick, the old, the warehouse.
Right, I love it.
I think it's the best aesthetic. When you redo it, you know, I'm all for it, right? But I'm not all for, like, oh, we can't turn down that Chinese food place because it's been here since, you know, 1910. And you're like, it's a shitty place with a shitty sign. It's always been that way. And now you're labeling a historic monument. And now no one can improve this area. You know?
Right.
Shit happens.
Yeah, it's called progress, everyone.
And the thing about it, though, is they're talking about in historic areas. I'm just rereading everything here as I go, right? That you know, a moratorium on demolition of downtown buildings in historic areas. That is totally bullshit because, like, all around Shakespeare, shit has been demolished and rebuilt. It's not like this is some pristine, like, walk back to 1973 or 6 or whatever. It's like, no. Shakespeare's is now one of, like, the last rickety-looking build. Not even rickety. It's a nice building. You know what I mean? It's the last building there with character.
That building, but that looks like it was built, like, really early, like, 40s or 50s. would be my guess on that brick. Like, I don't know, because you said it was 70s, but I don't think
Shakespeare's opened.
It's not a 70s. That looks like it's older architecture.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because they don't
now,
build.
That does not look worth preserving.
Again, it's
wait a minute.
You know, maybe.
It kind of is. I mean, look at it. It's kind of a classic. I mean,
it's classic for
they
sure.
They don't make buildings like that. There's a whole part of Orange County.
Excuse me.
Yeah. Orange County, it is a historic district because all of the houses are like old school Orange County. And there's parts of LA that are like that too. And it's nice to do that. It's nice to preserve those. Having said that, I like what they do in San Francisco where they'll preserve a portion of the building. But they'll like a lot of the times they'll preserve the facade of it, the original brick facade, but then they'll build something around it.
Like Dolby's facility or something.
It's yeah.
Amazing.
Which is awesome. Or there's an
Autodesk has done it with a few that are old warehouses, and then they have certain tricks of glass on the outside.
Yeah.
Like they're combining it. You know, you see a lot of it in Europe and England. Beautiful ways to do it. When they go, no, you can't change anything, it's kind of like progress.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and that's the thing. You got to just kind of get over it, right? Because like that building, I don't know. Like, I know it's probably a lot more expensive than to just demolish the entire block and build from new. But like, I do like this is a part of San Francisco developers that come in and say we're just gonna build on top of it. Like, you're still gonna have sort of some of the existing structure. But oftentimes the problem is when these guys build things, they'll go in, they look at the foundation, and it's just cracked as shit, mm-hmm. and it's bad. And like mm-hmm. to build anything on top of it would be structurally unsound, mm-hmm. and so you just can't do it. You got to demolish, pour all new foundation, and go from there.
So still looking for how old the building itself is. It's here on the demolition application. Is the building or structure to be demolished more than 50 years old? Yes.
Yeah.
Is the building structure in a historic district? Is it a landmark, or has it otherwise been recognized as historically significant? No, is what it's been checked on the application.
Mm. But it's the best pizza.
That's 100% correct.
Clearly, the standards are just...
So that's the thing. Is like that's what I'm saying. Is it feels like knee-jerk reaction from local politicians to the nostalgia of it's... Not to mention Columbia citizens, but also, you know, alumni of Mizzou or whatever. It was one of those things where I went from being jokingly, oh, that sucks, they're going to demolish Shakespeare's, but whatever, it'll still be Shakespeare's, to like now legitimately upset that they're trying to stand in the way of these people. I don't think they should do this. Private business should be okay. I feel like they're trying to change. They're putting this moratorium on it probably to set some freaking rules up to deem Shakespeare's historic, to protect it that way. It's a bunch of bureaucratic stuff. I don't like it one bit. The city council is too big for its britches, Lauren.
I hear you.
So everybody's happy for Shakespeare's. It sounds like they're going to make a lot of money from this shit. Because now it's like they're fucking making headlines and stuff, and now it's a national monument and all this stuff. It's like,
I mean, Shakespeare's prints money hand over.
Yeah, but
it's the most successful local business in Columbia, Missouri.
That's great, but I feel bad for the people that own the building because
right they, now they're
I don't know, like I don't know the laws or legality of how you can sell a historic landmark, and there might be some zoning issue. I don't know this for sure, but there might be some. I wouldn't be surprised if there's some sort of weird regulation that says they have to sell it to the state. Which is might be okay because they might buy it for top dollar, but I don't know. That's really weird. Like
that's been happening a lot lately.
Yeah, I mean, like if you want to sell it to a private developer, it's whatever you negotiate the price for, and they can do whatever the hell they want with it. Mm-hmm. But like when it becomes a historic landmark, there might be some very interesting like loopholes you have to jump or hoops you have to jump through on that. I will say this, Greg.
Yes, please do.
About 3 months ago, they closed a place that was near and dear to my heart. Now it wasn't because it was a historic landmark, but if I could have gotten a historic landmark status, I would have.
Yeah.
All Star Donuts on Chestnut Street.
Well, of course.
And
well, of course.
The reason this place is so iconic was A, it was one of the best donuts in the city, hands down. B, open 24 hours a day.
Wait, it's gone?
Gone.
The one on Chestnut.
Gone. The sign's still there, which is the saddest thing because the sign remains there unlit all day, every day, all night.
It's like a tombstone.
And it's terrible. And they're going to, you know what the shit thing is? Because the association on Chestnut Street sucks. Because there's, you know, every neighborhood has associations where they get to vote what comes in. And oftentimes the only places that can afford it now are big corporate chain stores, which prior to like, I don't know, maybe like 10 years ago, you weren't even allowed to have. Like Apple being on that street is amazing to me that they even got that space. Now there's a Nike store. Now there's all this other stuff like in that neighborhood. But yeah, what happened was their lease was finally up. And they went to renegotiate, and they asked for something so astronomical. The donut store was like, "We can't cover that. Sorry, like we got to go." And they had to leave. And now they're putting something else in there, which I'm sure will be another delicatessen bakery that'll sit there for about a year before the owner goes, "Well, shit, we are not making any money on this, and we gotta close this down." And then
let's
eventually,
start making apps. And then they what's go do that? Then they go make apps.
Yeah, then they'll go make apps. Mm-hmm. What I want is, I mean, it sucks because you literally like this thing was a staple for me in the city. Like we would party in the marina, we'd go get a donut. Or whatever the hell you wanted to make. You should make a sandwich and all that stuff too. Mm-hmm. And they were good donuts. And it sucks.
Apple fritters were good there.
Because if I could have gotten that historic status, mm-hmm. I totally would have. Because mm-hmm. it's also one of those old school buildings. You can tell that's a building that was made when this neighborhood was formed. So
here's the area I'm excited about is Dog Patch. Mm. So if you take that historic district, and if they don't knock it down, and I think they now have all the ordinances to rebuild it, they've got the permissions to redo it, but now you've got hundreds of thousands of square feet of old. Some of these buildings are built in the 1830s and 40s, right?
The big
amazing
old,
ship, the biggest shipyard of old historic buildings grouped together west of the Mississippi.
Interesting.
Right? And I've been down there because I'm trying to figure out what they're going to do and hopefully, you know, coordinate some plans with it. But finding that old warehouse-like living space is so impossible, right? But it's a gorgeous aesthetic. You can't redo it. I mean, I live in a house that's got reclaimed wood. It's post and beam. It feels like that way. You know, it's hard to do, right? There's only so much of it out there. You get into different things. But if you can get into a warehouse where it was built a couple hundred years ago, or if it's earthquake reinforced but using wood beams on brick structures, wow, it just is like layering on the gorgeousness.
You know,
you can't build like that anymore. You can't cut beams like that anymore. You know, there's beams that are like, you just can't. They don't do it.
We're in a similar situation. A lot of people always ask us, like, man, how did you find the one castle in San Francisco with these bricks back here?
We had to look for it, actually.
It was hard. And
we looked specifically. We put an ad in the paper that said, if you have a room for rent in your castle, in your Scottish castle, let us shoot there. The more it looks like Highlander, the better.
I've never thought about this as a castle, but I really like it.
What do you think it is? What do you think of it?
We should do a little fake, what do they call it, the arrow, where you can shoot the arrows out of it?
Traps.
No. The turrets.
You know what I mean? The holes, the windows they cut. So like
the little glass window.
Well, not a fake one. We should do a real one. It'll be good to protect the moat.
This is why we like it.
I always love the O of
See, this is what you can do for people stealing the garbage. Exactly. Pour boiling oil on them.
I like this.
Whenever we bring somebody who's watched this show into this room for the first time, this is
really small.
So much bigger on camera.
That's fortunate though for you. I hope that works out for you. There was some really cool stuff happening when we go to E3. We used to stay in Airbnbs, and I stayed in an Airbnb that was an old like textile warehouse, and they
had long rows.
It's weird. And they came in and obviously built. They had to build all the infrastructure, and they made it into like condos.
Yeah,
that were some were like studios, some were like two bedrooms, something like that. But it's just cool what you can do when you've got that space. So I don't know. I'm also very partial to warehouses because in the movies, all the cool stuff, interesting stuff happens in warehouses.
Most of the
that's where all the stuff's dealt out.
Definitely. You
know? Oh, yeah.
A lot of good scenes from Breaking Bad happen in warehouses.
You store things there.
Well, they're untouchable. I saw them first. I really got turned on to it. I mean, I grew up in New England, so there was a lot of, fishing villages type of things where there was still old shipyards and stuff, and that was interesting. But going to school in New York in the 80s and seeing Soho, was like, wow, that was the first time I saw artists had studios and their own gallery, or they had the space and they got there early when it was still, when I was working there, it was still scary at night. Now it's untouchable. A loft will cost, you know.
Thanks, Giuliani.
A big loft. You know, it's weird because for a fascist, he actually cleaned up the city, which was kind of scary to me. I was like, this guy's such a prick, but the city's better. What happened to all those homeless people? No one knew, and that was really scary.
I always thought it was cool when you see those old lofts, right? They're just big open spaces, and they'd have the big freight elevators, and you'd see movies where people would ride their motorcycle onto the freight
elevator. That's what I'm
talking
about.
And just ride it up and then park it in your house.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that was just always cool to me. Like,
real world shit.
There was one.
You ever see Diva? The movie Diva?
No.
The French movie? Oh, it's great. It's got one of those.
I'll check it out. Yeah. The one that comes to mind, obviously, it's not an old 80s movie, but for some reason, the Tron Legacy popped in my brain because he had like a warehouse style apartment that he could just ride up the dock onto and park his motorcycle and like open the roll door. And it was just like, that was his apartment. I'm like, that's awesome. I want something like that. But in San Francisco, it would cost you about $10 mil. Or like, not that much. It would cost you maybe like $2 million maybe to get like big loft.
Basically. That's entry, yeah. Yeah,
small. I mean, it's like, you know, studio loft.
Yeah.
So it's too crazy. But I don't know. I think the real estate market up here is insane. All up and down the peninsula. All up into the.
But I don't see it changing.
It's not going to. It's just going to keep going
until
up.
Until like another internet bubble bursts. And,
yeah,
like,
but the
developers
problem was,
can't afford that stuff, but that's not going to happen.
The problem was even when it burst in 08 and like what the period he's talking about. Everywhere else in the country dropped down to the bottom. San Francisco, like me.
It did. But I mean, I got to live in that awesome high rise. Like, I mean, it did, it, you know, there was a change for sure.
That's true. And a lot of places couldn't develop. So there was a lot of development like that had to halt. But I mean, the rest of the country is still catching up.
We're
building Twitter buildings for Twitter
right now.
Like, oh, you work at Twitter? Here's your building that you can live in right across the street from Twitter. It's like, are you kidding me?
You got all these companies, you know, I mean, just take the slate right from the tech, from the chip companies to Intel, NVIDIA, and then you get into the gaming space. You got the EAs, you got everybody else around. Then you get into the film space. You got Pixar, you got effects companies, you got that.
Yeah.
And then you get into, you know, the YouTubes, the Googles, the Facebooks, kind of the Twitters. These are all already, they're already public companies. They've already gone through their burst.
Right.
Now they're really just on the growth sustainability.
Right.
Well, not really sustainable, you know what I mean? they're on their trajectory of just make more, but they're all just dominating more and more market share as they go. None are falling off the tree, right? And here we have a community where the whole world is interfacing basically through San Francisco. Mm-hmm. I mean, their wires aren't actually going there, but all the software they're using is.
Sure.
All the management,
Square, changing the world, Uber changing the world. Did Uber start here? I thought it did, didn't it? So you've got like this tech, aside from Port City, you know, like you've got these emergences of different things that are so tight and there's so little space. It's like, what's going to happen? And it's surrounded by hills, so you can only build. You know, I remember hearing Bob Hope tell, I was reading books on the history of LA, the music business, and it was people saying, well, I asked Bob Hope, you know, I was a young, successful actor, and I asked Bob Hope, you know, how do I invest in LA? And they said, go to where the roads stop and start buying.
Yeah.
And it was like, that was their model.
That's smart.
To buy LA. It was like, just go to where the neighborhoods start and start buying, and eventually it's going to be worth something. And
eventually catch up, yeah. But unfortunately, you can't do that anymore here.
Yeah.
Because now all they can do is, like, they face the same problem they face in, like, places like Japan and Tokyo, where they can just
go up.
Yeah, you can't build out anymore. Or you can try, I guess, to make fake land like they did with the marina, but you know.
I just got back from Singapore, and they it was a few miles bigger than the last time I was there.
Really?
And they call it reclaiming, which is interesting. Because what are you reclaiming?
We're taking it back from the water.
You ever had it in the first place? No. Yeah. But it's actually, you know, quite interesting. I mean, that is a country is very interesting. Mm-hmm. I mean, we could learn so much from what they do. But they're just building more stuff. The hotel I was staying on was basically water. It was water last time I was there 20 years ago. Wow. Now it's, you know, one of the most insane hotels
build
in
land.
The world.
Yeah, I mean, you say the old adage for real estate is like, you know, it's the best investment because God's not going to make any more land, right? Yeah. Like there's a finite amount of land and space that you can technically buy on. But I guess that's not true anymore. I guess we can start building out into the ocean and seeping our, like, you know, draining our seas so we can
make
more.
That's what you were talking before, like air rights became something. You know, I was living in New York, and then they built a building next to us above a school. So there was a private school that decided to sell their air rights. And I think they sold the air rights for $14 million. And all they had to do was basically shut up, not get hit by shit that fell down, let the school build around them and over them. Mm-hmm. And literally it became like this glass tower, enormous, but the private school was still that same school underneath with some more support beams running through it. And they got, you know, they sold those air rights for $14 million.
Damn. Shit. You know, Kevin, let's sell some air rights.
That's
yeah. You're in? All right, good.
Ready.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's another episode of the Game Over Greggy Show. Lauren, thank you so much for coming.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I love you guys. Thanks for
everybody.
Having me.
Oh, thanks. It was our pleasure. Follow him. His Twitter's been popping up all the way over there. If you're listening at home, it's Lauren_Lanning. Buy Oddworld. Support him. He's making more. He's being dodgy about what happens after.
Please do. Please keep us in business. Yes.
Yeah, no, it's our pleasure. You were great today. Thank you so much for hanging out.
Actually, hey, it's my pleasure. It's great to be here. Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you didn't know, the Game Over Greggy Show is simple. Each and every week, four, sometimes five best friends gather around this table, each bringing a random topic of discussion for your amusement. If you like that, you can throw us a few bucks on patreon.com/kindoffunny and get the episodes each and every week on Friday. If you don't want to give us any money, no big deal. Head over to youtube.com/kindoffunny, where each topic is broken out day by day until we post the entire show on Friday is an MP3 and, of course, a full-on video. Until next time, Tim's going to Burning Man.
Oh, yes.
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 Yes, it's highly happening.
Go.
Spring break Go. Forever.
Spring
Naked
break.
Girls.
Oh, my God.
Sushi bars.
No.
Sake bars.
I wouldn't eat sushi bars
in the desert.
Man.